happy for our fans. This is an important game to everyone, so it's good to be state champs. And you know what? Hey, Shane's doing an awesome job down here. He really has. And they're doing a great job, and I have no doubt they're going to get better and better.
Thanks, Coach. Congrats.
Thank you.
Clemson needed to worry about winning the football game because we had a confident bunch and we had a hell of a football team coming in here. And I think the narrative was that we were a feel-good story. We got a good football team and we showed it.
All right, well, congratulations on the win, Coach.
I'll be home for Christmas.
Fluke. Noun. A lucky or improbable occurrence, with the implication that the occurrence could not be repeated. The first goal was just a fluke. Fluke. Verb. To obtain a successful outcome by pure chance. I fluked a pass in the multiple choice exam.
When it comes to, you know, wins like last year, after such a long stretch of dominance from the other team, that team's fan base would sit there and tell you that that was a one-off. It was a flukish win. If the Gamecocks win tonight, they validate what they did last year, and they would essentially announce to the rest of the sport, they have completely turned the tide in this rivalry.
What a advantage it is to have this game at home. Shane Beamer, 11-2 in games that start after 7 o'clock at home. He's won 8 consecutive contests as head coach of the Gamecocks in night games here at Willie Big.
Anytime Gamecocks kick off in Williams-Brice Stadium, it is going to be a tremendous atmosphere. But at nighttime, when you allow folks to be out, parking lots opened up a little bit early today, it's going to be an incredible atmosphere. The production throughout the entire game is second to none. And Willie B will be rocking, and it will be a very, very different environment than Clemson has faced on the road this year.
Williams-Brice Stadium, by far, will be the largest away crowd he has ever played in front of this season.
We're at Willie B tonight, and I think that's a huge thing in this ball game tonight. Willie B could be the difference tonight.
There is real momentum on the Gamecock side, and having this game played at home feels critical, as Spencer Rattler has been very good at home this year. And in general, really, Beamer's teams have played better at home as well.
Bring the Tigers on down, Dabo, and get ready for a Tiger skinning by the Gamecock. We gonna beat you, and I want you to come on down.
If we can average 3 to 3.5 yards in the run game, that we can win this football game. One thing that gave me a whole lot of belief in that is the end of the game against Kentucky. Spencer Rattler led us down the field for a game-winning touchdown, and everybody and their brother, you knew, I knew, that we were going to try and find Xavier Leggett in that touchdown situation, and guess what we did? Xavier Leggett got the football.
Gamecocks have scooped up every bit of talent in the state of South Carolina. Clemson does not have one commitment in the Palmetto State, the 2024 class. Would a victory tell? Could we go as far as to say something bold like, whoever wins this game will kind of show you the trajectory of both of these programs? One goes one way, one goes the other.
This is the first time in a very long time that this game has actually been the biggest game of the year for Dabo. Things could maybe go off the rails if they drop another one. They were saying that this 2 could almost equal 5. If that makes sense.
Yeah, no.
I know we're doing weird math. 5 in a row was awesome, but this 2 in a row might be more devastating than that.
Gamecocks are the seeds with the number one schedule in the country year after year. The fact is, Gamecocks beat Clemson in every sport they played them in last year, except women's softball. They beat them in basketball, baseball, soccer, chess, checkers, pickleball, tennis, everything they played them in, except women's softball.
We've seen enough of Seven over these past 2 seasons to realize that he is a game changer. When that pressure is coming at him, when he's facing his most difficult task, that's when he's been at his best throughout his career at South Carolina. So I think it's going to take more than just initial pressure from Clemson to be able to throw him off his game. He's got talented wide receivers. If he can get any help at all from the offensive line, Spencer Rattler is going to be able to put his thumbprint on this game.
If it weren't for us being at home this year, I'd be really, really, really concerned right now, but
with it being a home game, a home environment, we'll let, as Q said last week against Kentucky, we'll let the fans handle Kate Klubnik and Clemson. I'll let the fans get in Kate Klubnik's head. Because, by the way, this is the biggest venue he's ever played at, by far. The most intimidating, for sure. It's not even close, honestly.
Clemson basically came out and admitted it today. They're pumping Sandstorm all week long into their practice. They can do that all they want. Under the lights in Willie B is just completely different. And, I mean, no disrespect, Clemson can only play who's on their schedule, but they have not faced an environment like they're walking into Saturday night. I mean, the place is going to be absolutely swaying.
It's not a tough feat. It's something you just did last year on the road. Clemson's limping into this thing as well. Now, they've had a couple of wins here lately, and Dabo saying the same stupid shit whatever.
And South Carolina at night is a different feat. It's becoming a scenario in which if South Carolina has anyone at home at night, they're going to win. It's just like, that's worth 3 points, worth 7 points, however many. It's worth enough to push South Carolina most of the time over the edge.
They think they're riding high after that North Carolina win, but it does not matter because they got to come to William Rice Stadium and the Gamecocks are ready.
There's no better environment in college football as far as a road game atmosphere than Williams-Brice Stadium. Huge road game environment, in my opinion. This is a different animal at South Carolina at night.
Rattler and Beamer are 6-1 in November.
Yep, 6-1 in November.
And that's pretty doggone good right there. That shows a lot of confidence.
I mean, look, a night game at Clemson ain't the same as a night here, Willie. We know that. And it's almost like they're story-eyed when they get that Sandstorm firing up for the first time at night. The lights are going crazy and the stadium feels like it's about to fall to the ground from people going nuts.
It doesn't take a miracle from an act of God for Carolina to win. I don't think it's that bad. If Rattler gets hot, Clemson has to start bringing pressure to get them. You know, if they start bringing the pressure like they do, then Leggett could have a game. You know, Leggett and Brown, though, could have a major game.
I've seen some stupid stats come out. Oh, South Carolina has, like, scored, like, 103-13 or whatever against Clemson in the last however so-and-so or Williams-Brice or whatever. Well, guess what? Brent Venables isn't walking through those doors on Saturday night. I don't fear, and nobody should fear Clemson's new defensive coordinator. He obviously choked last season. So what's there to be afraid of? You know, a lot of people are, be afraid of our defense. Oh, what? You got to wash the big Xavier Thomas? So, I mean, what, 24 years old now, 23, 24 years old, still playing college football?
Hands down, no questions asked, fact. This will undoubtedly be the rowdiest, most difficult environment.
Obviously, Williams-Brice is gaining a reputation around the nation as being a place where it's a destination type of environment. People know that is an intimidating place to play.
Clemson was a playoff team, one loss. We stole their magic. We took them and put them into the gutter where they belong. Dabo is in good spirit and ready to take us on this year because he wasn't ready last year.
You know, last year it was close. Like you said, they could win, and they did. And, you know, this isn't like a regular game. It's going to be here, you know, in our place. So it's like, well, you know, stats really ain't going to matter here neither this time.
South Carolina at home at night in November. Taylor's oldest time. It'll give you a good shot to win yet again.
What they've created, it's, you know, you can't help but get wrapped up. I see opponents sometimes kind of moving a little bit, and I know they don't want to, and they probably get hollered at sometimes by a coach, but it's infectious.
The old argument that we've had with our orange-clad cousins, neighbors, whatever, does rubbing a rock and running downhill constitute the top 25 seconds in college? Well, that's awesome. We can all do that. Now, you can all go do that in your front yard or somewhere. You can put a rock and you can rub it and you can run. Can you have the firework display?
I look at the fact that North Carolina had almost 250 rushing yards against Clemson. They averaged almost 8 yards a carry against Clemson. You can move the ball on this defense. You can move the ball. You can make plays. If you're a South Carolina fan, you have a lot to like going in this game.
They haven't played against Rattler yet. They played against him last year. They haven't played against Super Mario. There's going to be a big Tonka truck running all over in the backfield. Like I said, Tonka truck is going to be running all over the backfield, plowing up the ground.
The biggest thing
is that environment at Williams-Brice, to me, is at least a touchdown advantage. And so those guys are going to be loud. Our fans are some of the best in the country, and that environment is just incredible now.
Clemson is not a team to fear anymore. They're not. Nobody's scared of that Tiger paw like they were 5-6 years ago. Last year's win changed all that. It changed all of that. South Carolina, they no longer, in my opinion, are scared of Clemson. This team is no longer scared of Clemson.
Knowing you can do it, Jay, we all agree there's times in life where you think you can do it,
right.
You think you can do something. South Carolina did it. There's a lot of players that will be there on Saturday night that did it last year.
It wouldn't hurt my feelings if he broke off a 500 piece like Jake Bentley did a few years ago in Death Valley, as long as we get a different result, right?
Yeah,
so. South Carolina at night at Willie B, under Shane Beamer's been a different animal. The place is crazy. Maybe we can get Darude back.
South Carolina fans losing, I think, kind of like, all right, it is what it is. Then they're not going to be thrilled. You feel like if Clemson loses this game, it's a losing season.
Disappointment, failure, any word that you would use to describe a season, this would be it. There's no way Dabo could talk his way out of this one.
Feels good to be good. Feels good to be one game away from a bowl game. Feels going to be one game away from bowl eligibility.
Not only is it just the experience that you're able to give to your players and your fans by getting postseason play, you also are getting additional 15 practices. And that's the biggest thing heading into any bowl, is that essentially you get another opportunity for spring practice. Have that experience of getting more time under the tutelage of the coaching staff, being able to learn how their roles are going to change. It's just so vital to continuing momentum and building a winning program year after year.
I think their secondary is the weakness of this group. With all due respect, I think Wiggins is wildly overrated. Makuba, when you go beyond those two in that secondary, what else do you have? A bunch of young guys, a bunch of, you know, these are literal, they're slow dancing at prom last year type guys. Like that's not even last year, a few months ago, they were slow dancing at prom, and now they're asked to cover guys like Leggett and company.
I remember last year's score, 31-30.
That's all you need to remember,
buddy.
Come
on down.
Yeah.
Yes, sir.
Loggins wants to exploit something. I think it's time to exploit Nick Harbor on their corners. That matchup between Xavier Leggett and Wiggins, they want to make it the show that they're, ooh, I can cover him, that's fine. Whatever y'all want to do over there, that's fine. He can't cover Xavier in the open space. He can't do it. So let that matchup happen. But I think Nick Harbor against their freshman, Terrell, who's like 5'8", 5'9", is literally what we need to exploit. I would literally fade route Terrell to death until they put a safety over there. I would fade route him to glory. I would literally let Nick Harbor catch the ball, tap the ball on his head, and run for a touchdown. That's what I want to see.
When you're sitting back there and you hear the student section and all the fans all around and they're just going crazy, and you can visually see opponents flustered or they're looking around, they're confused, or they're confused on the play call or anything like that. Kind of just feels like you have an extra man out there. You know, you have an advantage.
If you hear the booing in the background, folks, that's the student section as the Tigers do their arm-in-arm walk from about the 30-yard line as part of their pregame warm-ups, and then taunt the opponent's student section in the north end zone. That's do what they do. That is what it is.
Clemson's better at the lines of scrimmage. I understand that. How many turnovers is Clemson still averaging through the whole season? What's your number? 2-3?
Yeah,
you know, it's fine, but who's the better quarterback? Who's the better quarterback?
Klubnik has how many fumbles? 9. He's top 5 in the country, but sure, walk in the park.
Xavier against Nate Wiggins, I think that should be a fun one. But at the end of the day, man, Zay is just such a matchup nightmare. But that's 6'3", 230 coming at you, right? Every play.
I have to, again, I really, as I sat there on Saturday night and watched this crowd, the opening, the pregame, or the train, the cocky boots, sure, or wherever it comes out, and you've got the beat, you've got the smoke on the scoreboard, you've got the little fireworks that are going off above the scoreboard, and just the building of anticipation. It really, I don't want to hear anything about rubbing a rock and running down a hill and how exciting it is and a little cannon goes off. This is the best entrance in college football.
These last couple weeks, we've seen more and more of Lenore Sellers in meaningful action, not just riding the clock out. I would be absolutely shocked if he doesn't throw the ball 5 to 10 times against Clemson Saturday. I think they're going to put him in. They're going to lull him to sleep with the zone read. And then I think on a second or third down, you're going to get to see the arm talent that Lenoir has. And I fully expect him to be an integral part of the passing game.
You can't escape the fact that Clemson has been pretty bad on the road this year. There's really only two quality wins, if you will, for Clemson.
Williams Brice at night, whole lot of momentum. Clemson has not played well on the road this season.
Home and road or night and day, they're just a better football team, you know, at Williams Brice, especially at night. And I think that's going to be a huge thing.
Over throughout the season, we've seen teams that, well, their offensive line won the best in the world, and they were still able to do things against that defensive line. I don't respect Clemson's defensive line anymore. There's no dogs on that team like there used to be. That's not the same Clemson defensive line. It's not the same Clemson defense. Brent Venables does not walk through that door on Saturday night. It is as simple as that.
They have a major advantage at kicker in this game. Clemson's kicker issues have been well documented this year. They pulled a player in midseason. Jonathan White's was he a former walk-on who sold eligibility or something? Do you know how many field goals over 40, not over 50, over 40 Clemson's hit all season?
One.
Wow. 41-yarder. They've got one kick over 40 the whole season. So, yeah, that's absolutely an advantage for South Carolina this game.
There's no pressure on Carolina this week. I feel like all the pressure's on Clemson. You know, you don't want to embarrass yourself and lose to a 5-6 football team that struggled for 80% of this season.
Eric Kimry, who said he feels like a night game at home in the SEC could be a 10-point swing for the home team.
Williams Brice, this is a night game. This is the last game of the season. As you mentioned, playing for a November to remember, South Carolina has to get this win to go bowling. I think that stadium is going to be loud. It's going to be rocking.
Keep Spencer Rattler upright. They don't even have to give him all day. If they can give him 4 to 5 second pocket, he's going to step up and take a hit. And I promise you, he will carve them up like that Thanksgiving turkey.
Clemson has not been good on the road. They have not run into an environment like this. Kate Klubnik has not played in this type of environment as a starting quarterback. I think all that matters.
In the passing game, we can definitely take advantage of their secondary, because their secondary is still ass booty butt cheeks. I don't care about Nate Wiggins, okay? He's a good corner, but nothing really that special, man.
Well, Clemson's defensive line doesn't have the depth that they used to have.
They don't have that type of depth anymore, but the reality is the secondary is where you can attack. The secondary is where this group is pliable. They have a lot of problems handling the moment of truth.
If Shane could pull this magic trick out of his bag of tricks, he will be certified, in my opinion. There will be nothing that anybody could say to
him. Shane Beamer winning will send off a party in this town for two in a row that it's been a while since we've seen. You're not celebrating 6-6. You're celebrating two in a row over Clemson.
You beat Clemson, all of a sudden, hey, you won four in a row to close out the year. The vibe of the season feels a lot different.
I think it is enough for a South Carolina win. I think the Gamecocks win this game. Be there. Be loud. Celebrate after we win. Heck, rush the field. I don't care.
Oh, I got 35 good guys. Maybe 20 for them clowns.
30?
Up there, 30. The northwest corner of the state.
Being at home at night under the white and red lights of Williams-Brice Stadium, that crowd's going to be crazy. I think they're going to be fired up. I think they're going to be motivated. So give me USC.
Start a winning streak once again, that team in the upstate.
Yeah, I do. I think South Carolina wins the ball game. The atmosphere at Williams-Brice will be nothing short of electric. If we win the rushing battle, oh my goodness, yeah, we'll 1,000% win the game. I like Carolina to win a 28-21, 28-24 type game where it's going to be back and forth. And I'll take South Carolina to lock in a bowl win, get a streak going against Clemson.
I still think it's South Carolina. I think the Gamecocks are going to win this game 20-17. I think South Carolina's offense, they make enough plays at the end to where the Gamecocks find a way to get that sixth win and they become bowl eligible later this evening.
Picking the Gamecocks in a narrow one. I see South Carolina doing just enough. Points are going to be hard to come by. But I've got a 3-point win for the Gamecocks, and I believe I picked 27-24.
I got the Gamecocks too, and I've got it at 24-23. Another 1-point game. I actually had a one-point game in my prediction last year, so I'm going to stick with that. It's a homer pick. We'll see what happens.
Spencer Rattler plays differently when he's at home. I mean, so
sure.
Give me 24-23. South Carolina makes it 2-0, finishes the regular season 6-6 off of a four-game win streak.
Something Beamer talked about earlier this week, it was the loudest he ever heard William Bryce Stadium. You have got to create chaos. Mm. It has got to be the loudest. So get behind them, boys, because I think if you make it out to here, you're going to watch another SEC upset. Give me South Carolina 31, Clemson 28. Abbo crying in his khakis on the sideline.
I say we beat Clemson at home. Cade Klubnik, I know they said that he was going to be the one that should have played and beaten us, but I think we beat them at home. I mean, I think it's the tides are changing, and Dabo's got to figure that out, that we're not going to lose.
Two-score Gamecock win.
Yeah.
I'm saying 31-21 right now.
Hell yeah.
Go.
Turn my swag on, Gamecocks win.
You know, South Carolina, I know, beat Clemson to death last year. Williams Rice is nuts. That counts for something. The longer this goes on, the longer this week goes on, Spencer Rattler, last chance, right? Got that Senior Bowl invite. Thanks for the memories. Loaded QB class. Needs to show up in a big game. I think South Carolina wins this game.
35-28. The good guys.
35-28 for South Carolina.
Our guys are going to come out on top at home. Let's start a streak now. Let's get the streak going now. This is our time. They had their time. They're done. Dabo's washed up. He's done. He doesn't know how to make the right adjustments. He doesn't know how to make the right coaching hires. He doesn't know how to utilize the transfer portal. He's done. It's time for let the young guns in the game now. Let us take over the state. It's our time. We're doing it in recruiting, and guess what? We're going to do it right now in college football. South Carolina's our state. Clemson, you had a nice run, but it's over.
Give me South Carolina with a score of 24, and give me 24-21 South Carolina.
I don't think Clemson's man enough to win this game. I just don't. I don't think Clemson is good enough in the trenches. I don't think Clemson is good enough, like, from like a physicality standpoint. I think they are, for sure. But I think when you start looking at some of the stuff they're going to have to do to win this game for 60 minutes, I don't think they're going to. I think Clemson walks into a hornet's nest on Saturday. Williams Bryce will be absolutely rocking. And I think Carolina wins. 7-point underdog? Bet my parents' house that I'm in right now for Thanksgiving that they cover that.
Let me tell you something. I will say we will win the turnover battle 3-0. We will win the total of yards 450. 450 against your defense, you poor gentleman, talking about the Tigers. 450 total yards offense against your defense. You will get the strike of the rattler. He will get at least 380 yards passing. Four touchdowns, no interceptions. I'll say Clemson 24, Gamecocks 37. 37 against your defense. Kiss that great Tigers defense. 37 points.
Like I said 3 weeks ago, you got to start with a little tiny snowball at the top of the hill, and they've been pushing and rolling that thing all the way down. And I think they pull off a nice close victory tomorrow night.
Gamecocks will win. I think it'll be a lot like the Kentucky game. Yeah, Gamecocks should win the game.
Tomorrow night, Spencer Rattler and Xavier Leggett will go out with a bang, and that defense will create more turnovers than Clemson's, and I think South Carolina. It'll be raucous and wild in there, and I can't wait to see it. Gamecocks win.
I'm letting y'all know right here. 2 years ago, I told Coach I the downfall of Clemson was coming. And I promise y'all, the downfall of Clemson's coming, and we're about to bury the dagger in their heart Saturday night in Willie B. South Carolina 38, Clemson 10. Get the hell out of our state that we run. How about them Cocks?
Nobody comes to town without getting hit by a little sandstorm. Let's light them up.
Emotional roller coaster.
I'm not gonna lie, but I'm still celebrating the Clemson win. Here we are 3 weeks later, so I can't help it. Every time I come home at night, my son Hunter is here. Every time I come home, he's got a different one of our 8 wins that he's watching on the television that he's recorded just to relive it. So we'll celebrate that one for a while.
Rent is built.
Swing it out. That ball could be a live ball. Is it a fumble? There's no ruling yet. That's Khalil Barnes going into the end zone. A 43-yard return for a touchdown. The true freshman from Atlanta, Georgia, kept playing as there was no whistle.
Great job coming up by Makuba as he ends up tying up Leggett. Leggett knew that it was probably live. You can see him try to work his way back, and Barnes wisely scoops and scores. Already a quick swing.
Ouch, on the second play from scrimmage, the Clemson Tigers get a scoop and score off a backwards pass from Rattler to Leggett and run it into the end zone. The extra point can make it 7-0.
He thinks DeMario Anderson has plenty of time. He's got somebody down there deep, and it's intercepted. That's Barnes again. He was trying to squeeze it into Amarian Brown, but Barnes had him covered up. Four seconds of football, and Khalil Barnes already has a fumble recovery for a touchdown and an interception.
To Leggett, and Leggett can't get it, and Clemson does. Another turnover on back-to-back plays. The Tigers take it away on a deep post route, slightly underthrown with two guys in the same area.
And he'll try Mario Anderson, the Division II transfer.
Xavier Leggett
leaving the backfield, catching the ball and holding on to it, but holding his knee. And that's the last thing Gamecocks fans want to see. Shane Beamer runs out to check on it.
Well, it's a low tackle by Wiggins. Clean tackle. But you see Leggett's out there in bike shorts. Boom.
Quick throw to Knox, and Knox is tackled at the line of scrimmage. Now Knox is down two. Trey has missed some time this year due to injury, just like Joyner has.
Back-to-back plays. Nate Wiggins coming up. You see that nice shot right there on his inside knee. Gets the receiver down on the ground. Coming up field too far.
19 yards for Mario. Twisting and turning, and maybe gets a yard there.
Just like that. Boom. Good gracious.
Leaves the backfield here on a 2nd and 9. At least yet. 2nd and goal. Rattler throws to the 1, and Leggett is held out on a nice tackle by the true freshman, Avion Terrell, ending on the plays. Klubnik gives to Maffa, and Maffa goes ahead. And Klubnik will run it. Ran it well against the Tar Heels last week. Klubnik, as the Clemson Tigers go quickly, goes quickly inside of 5. Klubnik has all day, but eventually flushed out, and now will run for a 1st down.
You see Sanders come out. He ends up getting the initial pressure, and Klubnik just turns his back to the line of scrimmage. He's able to escape. It's all the way downfield.
Well, I said that it might be 4 down territory. Instead, here comes Jonathan White's. His career long is 41. This is 50 yards. The graduate player from Charleston. And White's nails it.
It's headed towards the south end zone, and it's good. That's the first of the year for Jonathan White. And how about that? He was 1 of 6 from beyond 40, and the Tigers take the lead.
Rattler hands to Anderson. Anderson might have lost half a yard. Gamecocks, but says it's the best decision he ever made. He throws this one-on-one ball to the sideline, and Leggett can't grab it as Wiggins was all over him. Third down. He had to get to the 45, and that's exactly where Anderson was stopped. He stopped this time at the 49 as Xavier Thomas wrestles him to the ground.
Anderson's had some success, as we mentioned, on the previous drive, able to get the ball going on the ground. This is not necessarily, and he's looked a little wobbly when he got up.
Player injury.
Well, Thomas slammed him down pretty hard.
Yeah, and now they'll tend to him. He's been banged up in recent weeks. Well, he took his helmet off. This is DJ Braswell's stench that comes in. Rattler facing pressure, and that ball is deflected at the line. Xavier Thomas pressured Rattler. It's fourth down to watch the state championship of South Carolina. Will Shipley. Out of the backfield, makes the catch, stays in bounds. First down, Clemson.
Will Shipley, explosive runner, no doubt, but so dangerous out of the backfield.
These families don't like each other. Clemson and Carolina families on this night are all 365 days of the year, and that play destined to fail is Mario Anderson covered up by Jeremiah Trotter. It's a loss of 6.
Their offense, they got to pick a first down now.
Anderson started his move from his own goal line and he didn't get much. In fact, he lost yardage. It was T.J. Parker.
Second down run.
You got to get to the upstate to get a first down. Third and 18 is dropped. Anderson can't make the catch. Loud in here. Third and 9. Klubnik throws. It's underneath. Shipley. First down. Down near the Gamecocks 32.
And Shipley came on the catch and run for 12 yards, and they moved the sticks.
Nice design play. Got to give him credit.
And Jonathan White having a night in Columbia. White was just 1 of 6 from 40-plus coming into tonight's game, and he has a 49-yarder and a 50-yarder.
And White knocks another one down after being 1 of 5 beyond 40 on the season. So he's had the half of a career right now, and it's 13-7.
Kick returner, now he's one of the best receivers in the game. Rattler in trouble, gets rid of it.
Xavier Thomas is working on our right tackle in a pretty big way, and that's Vershawn Lee.
Rattler's facing pressure and he can't get away. A jailbreak blitz by Barrett Carter, forcing a punt.
Nowhere to go for Spencer Rattler.
Blitz is coming. Rattler's got to spin out and can't do it. Sack all the way back.
My point.
All the way back to the 32-yard line. No chance there. A blistering Barrett Carter comes on the blitz, and it's minus 13 on the play.
This is one of the best defensive lines, if not the best in the country.
3 or 4 more yards. He picked 5 up there. Klubnik throws a one-on-one ball down there.
Carolina trying to pull the football down. There's a flag, and the Tigers make the catch. Tyler Brown, not Randall, Tyler Brown pulling down. It looked like Kilgore was, but they still brought the football in.
Snap, good hold. White's 3 for 3.
Kicks it up towards the north end zone, and it's good. White's is 3 for 3 on the night, and the lead is 16-7.
Spencer Rattler had over 300 yards passing in that game. He only has 34 in this game, and he tried to get it to Leggett there. Xavier only has 3 catches for 25 yards.
A bit quiet for Leggett.
On third and 18, Rattler's going down. Rukororo was all over him.
Here come the Tigers' four-man rush. Rattler in the pocket, in trouble, sack. Just giving them way too many shots at number seven. Minus nine on the play. Clemson's got a top 10 defense. And they're showing well tonight.
And it's Maffa. Phil, first down run, stays on his feet. Second and six to Maffa. First down again. That ball will be spotted at near the 30.
And it forced a turnover in everyone.
Mario Anderson met by a couple of Clemson defenders in the backfield. It was Peter Woods who first got to him. Then it was Barrett Carter. It's a loss of two.
Yeah, right now Clemson is winning the line of scrimmage.
Spencer Rattler, but he finally converts on a third down. They've also been bottling up Mario Anderson, who's been going backwards lately. Barrett Carter, what a performance.
Trying to run it, nothing going.
Can't do that. It's not there. Not there.
Minus two on the play.
Yeah, we just can't run against these guys. And
Peter Woods, exceptional defensive tackle, backup, a freshman at 315 pounds.
Second and 12, Rattler underneath. And that is caught by Tyshawn Russell. Russell, which is with his fifth catch of the year, is a crosser there. It'll be third down again for the Gamecocks. Wiggins tackled him.
Clemson effectively conceding that throw. It'll force this third and long.
Rattler over the middle, incomplete. Leggett had it in his breadbasket, but Barnes was draping him. Fourth down.
A great play by Barnes. He gets his left hand in front of Leggett. They brought everybody. They bring six. Pretty good pickup. You see Barnes, that left hand out in front, ball a little bit behind. If it's out in front a little bit more, I'm still not sure he makes that play. Barnes all over.
Shipley, Klubnik keeps it himself and busts it outside. First down. Empty backfield, throw it to Shipley. And will get turned the corner up near the 35. Dabo Sweeney, two national titles, four trips to that game, six playoff appearances, eight ACC titles, best winning percentage of any coach in ACC history, just under 80%. Boy, is he bullish about the future of this program with all the young players he has all over the field on a third and one. Maffa, first down, past the 40. Total yards since the first quarter and 94 for the game. Rattler running around, trying to buy time. He gets drilled as he got rid of it. And T.J. Parker crushed it.
Spencer Rattler gets absolutely planted right here. Boom.
On third and 10, Rattler trying to buy time. He's going to give it to Anderson. Anderson drops it. Rattler has had Tigers in his face all night.
Man.
And you can just feel these Clemson defensive linemen starting to talk about it now. They got Rattler, and they got the Gamecocks on our heels.
I think the worst thing about it is you can feel our offensive linemen talking about it as well. We just have no answer. We have no answer to this.
This season, after 4 years, Rattler has time, incomplete. Nice play on the ball by Avion Terrell as Luke Doty was the intended receiver.
As you can see, South Carolina trying to loosen things up in the passing game. Terrell's excellent corner. And is a young player.
His first interception against Georgia Tech. Rattler tries to throw a little bubble pass again. Anderson is flagged down. Nice open field tackle by Barnes.
Great job by Barnes. He's in the coverage in the slot over Leggett.
South Carolina, and who would have thought that would have been Florida's last win of the year? Shipley gets past the 20.
He'll hand to number one. Straight up the middle and a big hole at the 20.
And another Shipley run. He gets past the 30-yard line. Joiner in there now. Rattler just has to throw it into the bench. Pressure by Xavier Thomas.
Rattler had to scramble on the first down.
Thomas. Pressuring again as Rattler tried to get it to Harbor. Incomplete. third down. Rattler flushed on fourth and three. Can't get, well, he gets rid of it. It's caught, but short by Doty. Turnover on downs. It was T.J. Parker that was all over Rattler.
Rattler under some pressure, trying to hold the ball, throws it late, and it's caught, but well short of the first down. Rattler was going to the turf, and now it's turnover on downs, and the Tigers start to celebrate on the far sideline. Crossing routes, couldn't get anybody open. Rattler did everything he could. He went to the turf.
For Clemson tonight. Fumble recovery for a touchdown. Shipley bouncing off Gamecocks.
Well, it came in handy tonight.
Hoffa inside the 30. First down for Clemson, and South Carolina can only stop it two more times. A heck of an example of sticking with it. Hoffa sticks with it down inside the 20, and Clemson can just about run the clock out. Your high school man. Shipley can put the game away with a first down run, and he will. And he's out of bounds at the 5. Just think about it. Spencer Rattler just 112 yards passing. South Carolina only at 57 yards rushing. Just a total performance from the Clemson defense tonight from start to finish. And they win the game 16-7 over Shane Beamer, whose team finishes the season 5-7. Clemson is in the top 25, 8-4, going to a 13th bowl game that will be decided a week from tomorrow.
You see the two coaches there that were met at midfield, Dave Klubnik and his fellow Clemson Tigers, able to put a punctuation exclamation mark at the end of this one.
And Alyssa's with Dabo.
Coach, you said earlier this season to buy stock in this team. What does that stock look like right now?
Well, I tell you what, this was a hard-fought game. You know, to come in this environment and win the turnover margin, that's been the key for us this year. Wish we could have finished a couple more. We had some opportunities that we didn't finish, but really played our defense all night. And just proud of those guys. And we just kind of called it and played to it. And we made some big plays. Obviously, the score to start the game was huge. But really, just happy for our fans. But just happy. Happy again for our fans.
Let's do it, man.
Speaking of,
there he is right there. We got the trophy back.
Trophy back, man. You know we can't help
that. Yes, sir. This is what we do, man.
Congrats, Coach.
Thank you.
We'll celebrate that with your team, Coach Sweeney. It's the last Clemson win without an offensive touchdown was in 2014 against Louisville. They didn't have one tonight, but they get the win against the Gamecocks 16-7.
Carolina can't make it 2 in a row, and Clemson goes to 8-4 on the season. Carolina 5-6. So the 120th meeting between Carolina and Clemson goes to the Tigers. The final score, Clemson 16, Carolina 7. We'll start to recap tonight's game in a few moments on the Carolina Locker Room Report.
They bagged and pleaded. You keep the ball in the stadium in the fourth quarter. But when Clemson football walk in and knock on that door. Guess what? Look who's still here, point to the crowd. We still here. We standing on Ben. We standing on Ben.
Yeah.
won't be getting better if you're not embarrassed by a ball game like this.
That pretty much tells it all, Todd.
I guess so.
Are you going to cry now? Come on, cry, baby. Cry, buddy.
All this crying he does after games now, I'm starting to think he might have some low-T issues. As a fan, it's just, I mean, I've heard enough of the crying.
Cries at press conferences and you know, and cries in the locker room. This nonsense of being emotional.
Crying in your press conference. Crying at the end of a game.
Are you crying? Are you crying? There's no crying. There's no crying. She's crying, sir.
I quite frankly think it's a load of bull myself.
Crying, change, crying about? Legal, Ted, did you say this? Legal? Tackles? Legally? Tackling people? He's crying about that?
Check the numbers.
They're Shane Beamer's broken foot. They're the chain gang eating hot dogs. Their miserable existence comments. And their Beamer crying in the postgame. That's what I'll never forget from the 2023 season.
I'm so aggravated talking about Shane Beamer crying.
Emotional roller coaster.
Crying Shane Beamer. Crying Shane over there. He's just crying at the press conference. What's he crying about now? Is he crying about students? Is he crying because people left stadium a little bit early to get out there? You gotta beat the traffic. You gotta beat Brian Shane Beamer in the press conference. Every week he's got something to cry about.
That's
more embarrassing than the score.
It really is. I mean, that's ridiculous.
It's time for Carolina football. So get the out of your seats. Spurs up.
The rowdiest, most difficult environment.
I know he lies, Brian. Yes! This is Adam!
Are you kidding me?
Orange, black, find some pride. We're looking for signs of life here.
If you're going to come, please stay for the whole game. We don't need empty seats and a four-quarter dogfight like that.
Williams-Brice is gaining a reputation around the nation. People know that is an intimidating place to play.
You got to be embarrassed about this, too.
We're going to show out. We're going to be rowdy. And best of luck, too.
Oh, we don't care. We don't care.
Huge road game environment. This is a different animal at South Carolina.
That is absolutely ridiculous.
Oh, my gosh.
And going forward, if you're a season ticket holder or you're somebody that has tickets to a game and you're not going to come, please get those tickets to somebody else. Let me know. We'll put it on social media and get some tickets given away.
You know, this is about as quiet as I ever remember being at the Carolina Clemson game, Doc.
There's no better environment in college football as far as a road game atmosphere than Williams-Brice Stadium.
South Carolina, at home, at night, Taylor's oldest.
I mean, look. A night game at Clemson ain't the same as a night here, Willie. We know that.
I appreciate the ones that were in there. For those of you that didn't come and missed it, you missed one hell of a game, and you missed an unbelievable performance by our football team.
Wow. That's more embarrassing than the score. It really is. I mean, that's ridiculous.
Well, what do you want me to do, Rock?
They haven't really played in an environment like South Carolina. I would like to think that the SEC brings a little bit more when it comes to fans.
There's not a lot of energy in this place right now.
Dang well better check your heartbeat right now if you're a Gamecock, because pride is on the line. And I mean pride, your football pride, your manhood in general.
We need to be better with keeping this place rocking through four quarters.
Night. Oh my goodness.
Yeah, I've been better than this.
Don't understand.
I don't either.
And what you really don't expect are empty seats this early. A mass exodus leaving Williams-Brice Stadium.
Never again.
Pretty much tells it all,
huh? I guess so.
Never again.
Been restored. Clemson against South Carolina in the Palmetto State, 16-7. And the program that has made this state proud over the last decade is once again in its rightful place on top of the Palmetto rivalry.
I don't have a lot to say about that ball game last night. It was just an utterly embarrassing performance on both sides of the ball.
And that just made me think, too, this is going to be the last postgame call-in show for the 2023 football season because there is no bowl game, and that's sad. That's unfortunate.
Hope you had a lovely Thanksgiving, and I hope you guys got your laughs and your smiles and your joy in then, because Saturday absolutely sucked a lot of the life out of us and a lot of Gamecock Nation. Normally, I sit down, collect my thoughts, jot a couple things down. This one, it's just, we're just going off raw emotion here, just raw gut here, because I don't want to sit down and think about this one.
Falling after winning that last year, guys, and you were hoping you could find them put together two in a row, maybe start a little streak of their own. This is once again Clemson State in football. After that defensive performance by the Tigers, it was good.
I mean, we got to figure something out about people blitzing us. Rattler did not have the time. It's just hard to believe that we could not even get in field goal range one time. We did not have one field goal attempt. And that's very disappointing. It took the fans out of the game a little bit. The fans were jacked up. But towards the end, it was just so boring because our offense couldn't do anything. And, you know, it's just a disappointing loss. I think we should have done better than what we did. And like I said, we got to find a solution for the offense.
Now, with that said, Clemson's defense, I mean, you heard Todd and Tommy talk about it, and you heard Coach Beamer in the pregame conversation. He said on video, this is the best front seven they're going to face all year. And, remember, South Carolina played Georgia earlier this year, so Coach Beamer felt coming into this game that the front seven for Clemson was the best South Carolina would see all year, and you saw that tonight.
Carolina's offense didn't do much. And there's no other way to spin it. You know, I know Dowell Loggins is getting some heat about it. And it was not his best game. It was not the Lions' best game at all. It was not anybody on offense's best game, Spencer Rattler, Xavier Leggett included. Carolina's defensive kids played well. They still gave up 219 yards on the ground. And please ban Shadow of Death Valley. I'm not looking at.
Oh, I didn't even see that.
Yeah, this clown. It's, you know, go back to your mother's basement.
It was not a particularly difficult to understand or break down game. Clemson dominated South Carolina in every way and had no desire to put the ball in jeopardy for an entire half of football. That's what happened. Clemson beat South Carolina 16-7.
I got caught up in the moment. I said some things I probably shouldn't have, and I deserved the backlash. But I texted you, and I was like, why are all these fans strictly talking about, like, emasculating me? And then I was like, oh, I'm the idiot that said they weren't man enough. And they were. I was listening back to the other podcast we had that night. I think it was, like, Wednesday before Thanksgiving, too. And, like, I had some drinks before we recorded our podcast. And I'm sitting there, and I go, my buddy was like, did you say something about Clemson today that you shouldn't have? And I was like, yeah, I really got ahead of my skis on that one.
I know you guys are former players, but I can just see the looks on your face as you turn behind you and you see Clemson celebrating on your field. These are photos that will get back to South Carolina players, and these are images that are going to be in your head all offseason. What does losing to Clemson to end the year do as a player? Especially knowing the importance that for 365 days, this is what people talk about.
So my sophomore year was the year where they started 5-1 and ended 6-6, and Spurrier said that we don't deserve to go to a bowl game, and that was by far the worst offseason of my life.
Oh, God damn it. Jesus Christ. You got to give credit to these damn Clemson players, so at least they know the rules. I mean, they know what's going on here. I don't know if some of our defensive players would even know that was a live ball or not, as stupid as our defensive coordinator is, and shitty as he is, that they've even been taught that. God almighty, man.
I'm really looking forward to your rant today. Let the good times roll, fortune cookie. Let's go, let's go, let's go. You know, Ramona, remember last week when I picked Clemson to beat South Carolina, and there were a few Gamecock people who apparently must not have listened to the show on a regular basis, who were saying things like, oh, it's that's just your homer pick, Walt.
Homer pick.
I remember that.
Homer pick. It was a homer pick. Remember? Remember, Rona, in my homer pick that I gave the Gamecocks 13 points. The people who thought that was a homer pick felt that that was inadequate. It turns out, Ramon, it was a homer pick. It was a homer pick for South Carolina. They scored seven. You idiots who told me I made a homer pick. Your freaking team scored seven. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. You had 169 total yards in the game. In the game. Heck, I sat home and almost had 169 total yards. I mean, so, see, it wasn't a homer pick. You actually just sort of suck. That's the reality. Now, what you do with that reality from here is up to you. But you're just not any good. You've been beating, like, Jacksonville State and Vanderbilt.
Brian Shane Beamer. Crying Shane over there, he's just crying in the press conference. What's he crying about now? Is he crying about students? Is he crying because people left the stadium a little bit early to get out? And you got to beat the traffic. You got to beat it. And then Crying Shane's crying about legal tech. Did you see this? Legal tackles? Legally tackling people? He's crying about that. Crying Shane Beamer in the press conference. Every week he's got something to cry about.
I think we might need to get our boys' emotions in check down there. Especially during a game.
I saw a lot of, you know
and if you're crying in the post game, you know, I get it. You love your players. That doesn't bother me, but you might want to get your boys' emotions in check during the game. That has to be clouding your judgment as the game is going on.
I mean, maybe if your best player wasn't wearing a crop top and compression shorts to go play a football game.
54 wins in Columbia. That's amazing that South Carolina has had that much home field advantage in the series, because remember the first 57 years it was played in Columbia.
Yeah.
Every year. And Clemson had a 33-21 advantage. And by the way, Clemson is 18-6 in Columbia. That dates back to 1977. Wow. 18-6.
Rant is always due when we go to Willie B, the place that we have destroyed them all the time. You can decorate it any kind of way you want to. You can invite anybody you want to. But every time we come there after Thanksgiving, rent is due.
The life and vibrancy that was inside Williams-Brice was sucked out. You punted 8 straight times at one point, and there was just nothing in a consistent way for the South Carolina fans to latch on to.
One of the things going into last week was, man, the crowd at South Carolina at night, Kentucky had a hard time with it. Shane Beamer said it's the loudest stadium he's ever been in, even though he's been at Georgia, been at Oklahoma, been at Virginia Tech, been at Clemson. It's the loudest stadium he's ever been in. Couldn't hear himself through the headphones. Never heard any coach said he couldn't do that. Anyway, this place is bonkers. And do you know how tough it is to go into Williams-Brice with that, with Sandstorm 2001 and Cocky coming out, and he's got new interest, man. You get Black Magic, Red Fire Ants, and man, this is going to be unbelievable, all this stuff going on, right? Night game. I mean, just all kinds of hype about the best fans in the world until you start looking at wins and losses.
That score should have been 7-6 at halftime if it wasn't for that scoop and score and then that ridiculous interception that we should have had that went right through another defensive back's hands and led to 3 points for them. We had 3 quarters to score 10 points, and we ended a disaster of a season with a high note against our rival, and we couldn't come up with 10 points over the course of 3 quarters. But I digress.
The single best and most talented quarterback that South Carolina has ever possessed was only capable of putting up 112 yards and 7 points against this all-world Clemson defense. What an incredible performance defensively from Clemson in this game.
I think it had a lot more to do, Bill, with Clemson's defense is elite, and they played elite, and South Carolina's offense did not meet the challenge whatsoever across the board. I just think, bottom line, the offense failed.
And I don't think it's a Leggett thing. I mean, Nate Wiggins is a first-round corner. You know, I mean,
Yeah, I mean, he put the clamps on, man. He put the clamps on. So I said all week that I was looking forward to the matchup. I didn't do a lot of, and people wondered why I didn't do as much trash talking this week or whatever. I just was very wait and see on the game. I mean, I obviously picked a Clemson win. I didn't love the matchup. I didn't know how Leggett was going to fare. So, you know, give Nate Wiggins credit. He truly put the clamps on him. I mean, he got a couple. A great player like Leggett's going to get his, get a couple. But that Clemson defense, I mean, it's just, it's really hard to go up against a defense like that and have one bullet in the gun and expect to have a lot of success.
It was a disaster on offense. The Gamecocks lost the game. They did not look good on offense. Thomas, it was the first time this season I may have had times previously where I kind of disagreed with certain moves by D'Lo, but I just flat out questioned what he was doing on offense this week.
Bad. It was bad. Yeah.
The thing that maybe surprised me the most from the Clemson side of the ledger was just how chippy Clemson was. I saw it in pregame. You saw it in just how ferocious they were in tackling. The Clemson team really wanted this victory. And, you know, I had other people comment about even pregame, you could see a difference. And I have other people noticed it too.
They're not Georgia. They're not Clemson. We've said this before. They're not Ohio State. They're South Carolina. This is a program, and I know the fan base gets sick and tired of me saying this, but this is a program, and you look at the 100-plus-year history, they've only had eight wins, I think maybe 13, 15 times in the 100-plus-year history. So you have to know who you are. And the reality is this is a program that a couple years ago was an absolute mess.
Clemson has not just won these games. They've won them convincingly, because 16-7 is 9 points, and it didn't feel like a 9-point loss.
Listen, it's tough to beat Clemson because they got a good defense, you know.
Yeah, they have a very good defense, no doubt about that. I mean, you saw that on display tonight, only giving up 169 yards of offense to Carolina. So that's something, again, we mentioned this earlier. Coach Beamer said coming into this game, the best front seven he's seen all year.
There were some hits on Spencer Rattler that in the NFL, players would have been fined and suspended. And I'm not saying it was a dirty shot. The dude got planted like a little tree over and over. DJ Parker, if at some point in your life there sprouts a little Spencer Rattler in the middle of Williams-Brice Stadium, you'll know that was because TJ Parker put that dude in the dirt.
We don't have to make it pretty. Well, we're going to walk into your stadium, but we're going to beat your brains in for four quarters. The mentality that Clemson took into this game, where they were not going to be out physical, they were going to control the lines of scrimmage, and they were going to make South Carolina pay for last year, simply. And they did that.
Yeah, I know the scoreboard doesn't always reflect how the game went. From a physical standpoint, Clemson totally, utterly dominated in this game.
You can say, oh, it's a 9-point game. That mathematically was true. But in no way was South Carolina ever in this football game.
I just never felt like South Carolina was going to really, really have a chance to win the game. Because you could see the lines of scrimmages. I could see the domination at the line of scrimmage. And I knew for four quarters how that was going to wear the opponent down. And that Clemson was going to find a way. Clemson rushed for 219 yards, held South Carolina 57 rushing, but maybe the key stat of all, 112 yards passing from Spencer Rattler, and they handed him one of his worst games of his entire long collegiate career, but spanning two schools. One of his worst games ever. You could argue it was his worst game ever.
Shell shock city. You know, things started off really bad with a swing pass. It's inexcusable, and I love Xavier Leggett. You got to jump on that football.
Absolutely.
Don't. That's situational football. You have those practice periods in your practices for this very reason. You work on this. I am 40 years old. I have not played football in a very long time. And if I see a football on the ground during a game, my body makes me go ball, 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 ball.
South Carolina did not have the storybook ending that they were hoping for this past Saturday night as the Gamecocks fell to their arch rivals in the Clemson Tigers by a final score of 16-7.
Against Power 5 schools at home the last 10 years, South Carolina's 19-24. The Gamecocks are 19-24 against Power 5 schools at home the last 10 years.
I wonder what that number is if you take Vandy out.
All right, so we come into it from the offseason. We have an offensive line coach who basically has never coached in major, Power 5 football. Mm-hmm. We bring in up, we could have pretty much any offensive coordinator. We bring some guy in who's never coached offense in college football. We have no edge rushers. We have no running backs. The running backs coach is suspect. And we're literally going into year four and trying to talk about the offseason we're going to have. We're 5-7. For the first time in a long time, I feel like I'm watching Lou Holtz's offense run up down the field.
You know what's crazy? I was looking at the numbers, and he had an amazing year. He finished, I believe, and y'all are going to blast me if I'm wrong, but I'm pretty sure I saw this week, he finished with the same amount of touchdown passes as Cade Klubnik did, who everybody thought was terrible. So, I mean, I'm not saying he didn't have a great year, but, you know, I just – would it be worth $2 million? I don't think so. I don't think so. Nope.
You know as well as I do, you know, what you're saying is wait till next year, and Gamecock fans, they are tired of saying that, wait till next year. You know that.
Rattler's going to drop back, three-step drop, going to fire a long one, and he threw it. The same son of a bitch just picked it up. God, what are y'all doing? What the f*** are you doing? Who is this son of a bitch? It's number 36. I've never seen this mother.
That's a really tough game to lose, especially on home turf. You've got Williams-Brice Stadium as packed to the brims as you did. The atmosphere seemed great as always, but I mean, that's a really tough game to lose. Ultimately, you couldn't get the run game going. You're already short at running back, and then Mario Anderson takes a really hard hit early in the game, is shaken up, doesn't really play the same after that.
There's a lot to say here, but there's really not much to say, right? I mean, it's just one of those things where we all watched the same football game. We all have questions, and we will never get answers to these questions, okay?
They don't have the skin to be able to take it, and that's part of this rivalry. You have to be able to take it. It's kind of nerd behavior to not be able to take it. So I think any Gamecock fan out there right now that's still trying to clap back at Clemson fans, you should go ahead and give yourself a swirly and stuff yourself in a locker.
And so it was a nightmare year three. I mean, let nobody tell you different, guys. It was a nightmare year three. When you think about all the expectations, year three, this is year three. It's a really big year. Year three is massively important for a head coach. Year three is kind of the year you start figuring out what you got. It couldn't have gone any worse.
I was listening to the radio station here in Columbia, and the guys were saying, a lot of commentators, a lot of the media saying Clemson's going to win. But I just don't think that Clemson has ever played in a hostile environment like they're going to see at Willie B at 7:30 tonight. I almost pulled over. I was laughing so hard. Because I'm thinking, have you guys checked the record books of late what we have done to the South Carolina Gamecocks? I don't care if it's 7:30. I don't care if it's 1 a.m. in the morning, 2 a.m. in the morning, or 12 o'clock noon. We have smashed you guys every chance we get when we go to Willie B.
As I predicted before the season even started, Rattler folded like a cheap sweater in a game that mattered. Was he under duress most of that game? Yeah, of course he was. However, he had chances to make plays. And other than that throw in the second half, that one throw where he threaded that needle and hit that guy, he consistently threw behind receivers all game long. That interception he threw the second series, he put so much air under that throw. I don't know if he was throwing that to Joe Morrison or Jesus, but it surely wasn't going to any receivers in Willie B. Horrible.
deplorable, but not unexpected. I expected that from him. Spencer rattled. I'm sitting there talking to my kid, and I'm like, can you believe we got to run the razzle-dazzle to get 1 yard against Clemson's defense? I say good riddance to this guy. Good luck in the draft, whatever round it's going to be, third, fourth. What I do know is he better save that sign-in bonus because he's going to get cut, and we're going to be watching him in the XFL. Mark it down.
Wishing we were reacting to something a little bit more pleasant, but obviously you saw it, we saw it, we all saw it. South Carolina falling to Clemson 16-7 on Saturday night at Williams-Brice Stadium, wrapping up what is a 5-7 campaign in year number 3 for Shane Beamer and company.
Clemson said, all right, we're going to take the defense. We're going to take the special teams. Offense, yeah, we're not going to need you in this game. And you still cover the spread.
I mean, there are a lot of times they brought five people and got pressure within 3 seconds. It's just not enough. It starts with the O-line, but, I mean, to say that's something new, it's a broken record at this point. It's a complete joke when we're out there. I don't really know what else to say other than, you know, it is one thing, but, you know, it's not as if it was the only issue. There's a lot of things we had going on today that, you know, started with the O-line, but it was kind of a team effort there.
They got abused on the ground again last night. You couldn't stop the run again last night. They rushed the ball for 5 yards a carry last night. A little bit over 200 yards, 5 yards a carry. That's first down, second down, boom. You got a first down. You can't give up 200 yards on the ground and expect to win a football game when your offense is abysmal as what South Carolina's was last night.
You're watching the Gamecocks a week after they beat Kentucky. And really, it's just the entire game. In a 60-minute game, folks, there's 3,600 seconds. There wasn't a single second of that game where I felt like Clemson was threatened. Not a single second. If you're a Gamecock fan and you're honest with yourself, for a single second of that game, did you think your team was going to win? Like, it didn't feel that way at all to me at any point in the entirety of that game.
That crowd was amped up, as it always will be for a Carolina-Clemson game. You got the night game you wanted. You had a big win at night last week, and it got you to the precipice of postseason play at home. And on the second play of the game, a turnover after a lengthy review, obviously, but a turnover that led to a Clemson score was followed up by another turnover. And within three snaps of the football, that amped-up crowd was basically done for the night.
I don't think it was completely just our players' fault. I think the game plan fell flat, too.
The first half of the year, our play calling was great. And for some reason, the last couple of games, it just seems as if maybe Loggins is just, the bag is empty. He doesn't know what else to call. Or maybe there's been just such the amount of, like, I need these couple of plays to work to set up everything else. Then you run those plays early in the game, and they don't work. And therefore, you go, I got nothing else. Now, granted, if you're getting paid millions of dollars, you can't just sit there and go, I got nothing else.
This is another one that's going to probably hurt your feelings. South Carolina fans really need, and I think we did a good job of this, by the way. The reason I celebrated so hard last year, smoked the cigars, had such a good time, is because, guys, realistically, South Carolina beating Clemson over the long history of this rivalry has become nothing but a one-off. I know the five games in a row happened, but outside of that, guys, it's a rarity. Normally, South Carolina is winning one game to Clemson's every three or four, and that hurts, but that's the reality of the rivalry, man.
It is going to be remembered for Clemson's defense holding South Carolina to 169 yards and battering Spencer Rattler and tackles for loss and dominating the defensive line of scrimmage and getting, what was it, six consecutive three and outs? In the second and third, South Carolina had five series that started in the second or third quarter. They combined to run 18 plays for minus 14 yards. Minus 14 over two quarters of play. That's the story of the game right there. Jonathan Whiteson and Clemson defense.
An impossible start of the game to even fathom. And I've been watching the Gamecocks a really long time. You know, I was there 63-17. a couple years ago. I remember the 30-0 game with Clemson just pretty much doing whatever they wanted at Williams-Brice Stadium and probably could have scored some more points if they wanted to.
How does coaching work? Coaching is not, can your player make the play? It's not whether Spencer Rattler throws the ball. It's not whether Xavier Leggett catches the ball. But what supreme detailed oriented coaching means is if we don't complete this pass, make sure that you jump on the ball because it's a live ball. This is a lateral. That is something that you can prepare for in practice every time. That is contingency plan. So, yes, the coaches cannot affect the execution. I get that. But when coaching does come into play is when Xavier Leggett, who's a veteran, so you can't say anything. He's a veteran. He drops the ball. He's looking at it. AB's looking at the ball. The rest of the team is just standing around looking as if they've never practiced this before. That is an example of how coaches can get their players through situations. It's not about them catching the ball for them or making the throw, but there are situations that they can coach them through.
Going to some places on the road is tough in the SEC. I get it. But there's no way you can tell me that this is such a difficult place to play in front of the hardest fans in the country. You're 32-26 against FBS and 19-24 against Power 5. If that is the case, then your talent level, if the home field advantage is that big, then your talent, you must be terrible. If that's worth 3 points to you or 4 points to you or even more than that, what you say, just how tough it is, then, man, they must be really, really bad.
When I was on hold, I actually heard an advertisement for some generic Viagra on the station, and I was just wondering, do you think maybe we could ship some to Shane's office? Because I tell you what, all this crying he does after games now, I'm starting to think he might have some low T issues. As a fan, it's just, I've heard enough of the crying, you know. It bugged me in his first year when we beat East Carolina on a last-second field goal, and he literally cried with the reporter. It's like, dude, this is East Carolina we're in a dogfight with.
Clemson just systematically, body blow after body blow after body blow, demoralized the Gamecocks, demoralized Gamecock Nation, and made it obvious who the better of the two teams in this rivalry was.
I mean, I had Gamecock Nation, Mark, lashing out at me for making very clear comparisons, and I knew this was going to ruffle some feathers. I knew this was going to piss some people off when I said it. I said Spencer Rattler chose poorly transferring to South Carolina. A dozen other programs would have made him a top three pick. South Carolina wasted him and pushed him to the second or third round.
Like I said before the game, the one thing Clemson has is a running game. But the difference in the game would be the Clemson defense. I called it a line of scrimmage game and said South Carolina's just not going to win a line of scrimmage game with Clemson. And they didn't. And it wasn't a surprise. There was no other outcome that you could have had. It wasn't pretty, but they weren't going to need it against this bunch because South Carolina basically stunk on both sides of the ball here.
That whole offensive effort was just, there was no inspiration. And I mean, it was everybody was dropping passes. Spencer Rattler had a chance a couple times. They started bailing out early. If he'd have stepped up in the pocket, I saw there was a couple crossing routes he could have hit and kept some drives moving. But he just bails out.
I place all of this on the shoulders of Shane Beamer. You're the dude, man. You're the dude. You're the one who wanted the job. You're the one who said you loved it here. You're the one who said this place means the world to me. I love these kids, blah, blah, blah. You just fed us all of this stuff. And I quite frankly think it's a load of bullshit myself. I think it's a load of crap. And I don't care if there are Gamecock fans out there that agree with me. That's great. Agree with me. Hit the thumbs up on the video, and we'll rock on. If you don't agree with me, tough. I've got an opinion just like everybody else does. I'm f***ing done with it. I'm sick of this dude. I told you 3 years ago this was not a good hire. And guess what? Hindsight's 20/20, because I'm right. It's not a good hire. And it's not going to be a good hire. And they're stupid if they continue to leave him here and continue to just fester in mediocrity. But that's what they're going to do.
It is a loud environment. It is a fun environment. It is not an intimidating environment for Clemson. And for South Carolina, you got to be banging your head against the wall trying to figure out, how do we get our team to a place where they enjoy this more than Clemson does? Because as you said, Clemson for 40 years has been enjoying the environment at Williams-Brice Stadium. And the last four trips there, Clemson won by a combined score of 118-20. So it's not even close. Not since 2015 hasn't even been remotely close. And some people might say, well, Paul, it was a 9-point game. Did you think South Carolina was going to score anymore? Did you think they were even going to get a field goal range after about mid-second quarter of that game? Because I did not. That game was not close. That game was a blowout.
And with all the credit I just gave Clemson defensively, how good they are, that offensive output at home, at night, in front of a packed Williams-Brice Stadium, which I just – my heart goes out to Gamecock Nation. I empathize with Gamecock Nation because Shane Beamer complained about the student section. He complained about fans leaving early. And Gamecock Nation answered the call, but you know who didn't? The football team. Every time South Carolina played a defense that was worth a damn, they got shut down. Every time. Every time they played a defense that was worth a damn, South Carolina got shut down.
All five of the games that South Carolina has played against nationally ranked competition, they've lost by at least two possessions. I just want to see the team hang with the big boys. I'm not asking you to win every single one of these games. I just want you to hang. Upward mobility. The expectations, get into a bowl game and just be respectable. As much as I want to compete for a national championship, you have to set small goals.
I don't understand this. We're behind 16-7. You've shown absolutely no signs of life on offense all damn night. Why are you over here talking to the refs? Why are you in their ear bitching about what the fuck are you doing? Get with your fucking players, motherfucker. What the fuck? That's why I don't fucking like this guy. He's focused on the wrong fucking shit all the time, it seems like. He's focused on bitching at the fucking fans in his fucking press conferences. We're over here bitching and fucking hobnobbing with the fucking referees when we could be over here fucking trying to coach our fucking players up. I mean, I don't understand it. I don't know what he's doing.
I haven't been able to force myself to watch the Shane Beamer show or read any of, or watch any of the post-game interviews with any of the players. You talk about the fourth and goal being surreal with the Alabama-Auburn game. How about the whole Carolina-Clemson game surreal to me? I don't know if I'm more embarrassed than I am disappointed. I think it's more embarrassing than the 59-0 loss to Florida State in the mid or late 80s. To me, this game's on that same level. I mean, you got so much to play for. You're trying to play for postseason. You're in your stadium, sandstorm, and all that good hype up stuff. And that's about the ugliest thing I ever seen.
I guess a lot of people are saying it's worse than Muschamp, and again, the record is in year three.
Will Muschamp, 22-17 through 3 years at South Carolina. Shane Beamer is 20-18. The difference between those two coaches right now, I mean, Will Muschamp looks good compared to Shane Beamer right now, in all honesty. And I'm just going to ask you guys, you know, when are results going to matter to you?
It's freaking okay? Beamer.
You guys are arguing that Beamer is the guy. You know, and I'm just simply saying to you, at what point do results matter?
Shane Beamer forever.
It's now the end of year three, right? It's now the end of year three. Will Muschamp's winning percentage was .564. Shane Beamer's winning percentage is .526. Right?
But my question is, for Shane Beamer and his coaching staff, where was the creativity? Where was the special team stuff? You have an opportunity with about 10 minutes left to go, fourth down up near midfield, and you punt. You're down two scores. I mean, they almost coached timidly, it seemed like to me. They didn't stretch the field. They didn't try to, and Clemson had a lot to do with that, but didn't do any of the things that they were able to do last year against the Tigers, last year against Tennessee. And some of the things that we saw from them in special teams has been an area, I think, of average play at best at USC this year. And I was just surprised they didn't try a few more things, knowing that you were outmanned personnel-wise. You've got to make a few extra plays, and you'd already given Clemson a touchdown on your offense. You've got to find a way to get the crowd to stay in the game. And
all summer, we had a lot of Carolina fans getting in. and saying that anything under 10 wins is a failure for this team this year.
Yeah. Here's the dilemma that South Carolina faces. You're done with the hype era. You're done with the videos, the TikToks. You're done with crying in press conferences.
Are you?
No. I'm saying the fans are.
Oh, okay.
Fan bases. The fan base is tired of all of that. Okay, that stuff's run its course. You want substance now. You want a clear path. You want some winning. You want to see results. Beamer can do. He can go back and do all that stuff again all offseason. It's not going to work this time. It's just not going to hit. That message is not going to resonate with your fan base. And crying in your press conference about the effort your guys give and how they didn't quit and throw in the towel in a 5-7 season. That stuff may be 100% true. That is not what you say if you just lost your rival 16-7 in your own building.
They picked the worst game possible to have their worst game on offense. I mean, nothing worked. Nothing was good about that offensive performance top to bottom on Saturday. So just bad timing on that. And I think that, you know, you move into next season, year four of the Beamer era. You got some roster spots you got to take care of. And you also, you know, it's time next year, I think, for this program to be a little bit more consistent. I think consistency has been an issue.
Year three is looked at by many as sort of a launching point type year. It's a very important year in your growth of your program, of you as a head coach. Year three did not meet expectations. That is putting it lightly. When you have a season where off-field madness and what's being said in press conferences and the silliness that's taking place off of the field is the predominant storylines, that's how you know your season was, for lack of a better way of putting it, a shit show.
It just felt like we were shell-shocked. It felt like we couldn't get over what happened.
Yeah, and it completely takes your home field advantage out of it before you even have a chance to assert that. Again, yeah, offense was terrible. One of Rattler's worst games. He was pressing a lot. Yeah, he had a lot of pressure in his face, but let's be honest, he's been having pressure in his face all season. But this was one of the first games, maybe the first game, that I've seen the pressure affect his mechanics the way that it did. If you look, throw after throw he was making was off of his back foot. Just bad mechanics, and it got worse as the game went on. And the more he started pressing, the worse that was. You mentioned this may have been one of D'Lo, Dow Loggins' worst games, and I agree. I put a lot of this on him.
In the last 10 years, the Gamecocks have had 5 winning seasons and 5 losing seasons. The Gamecocks' overall record in the last 10 years, 58-66. They're 8 games under 500 in the last 10 years.
If you were born in 1980, you've seen South Carolina win in Williams-Brice Stadium 5 times in your life. That's people that are 43-year-old Gamecock fans have seen their team win 5 times. That's insane to me, because it's supposed to be, and it is, tough to win on the road. But for Clemson, Williams-Brice Stadium has been a place where they've been able to go in and just win a lot of football games.
And so finally you played a team with a real defense and they just blew you off. That's the reality of it. You weren't going to have a chance, and they can play this game another 10 weeks and the outcome is going to be the same every time. Every time it's going to be like 20-7. That's what it's going to be like every time, because you can't move the ball against Clemson. And so you have to go back to the drawing board if you're the Gamecocks and figure some things out, including whether Shane Beamer is going to be your coach of the future or not. I'm not sure about that. I think he'll make it to the end of next year, and then I think there's a really good chance that he gets fired, and maybe the AD gets fired too.
What I'm disappointed with tonight is I didn't see any creativity with the offense other than that sweep with Doty at the goal line, which was kind of a trick play, and we got the one touchdown. Where was the creativity tonight? You know, a bowl game's on the line, beating our arch rival. That's a disappointing thing from tonight that I can take is, where was the creativity plan on offense? Like, why didn't we utilize Sellers?
To lose to your rival in that sense
when you needed to get that win for bowl eligibility. Williams-Brice was absolutely packed to the gills. You saw very little orange in that stadium. You had every reason that you could come out and win this game. And things just did not break our way. There were mental errors. There were bad mistakes that ended up biting you in the ass. You're sitting at 5 wins. Shane Beamer has missed a bowl game in his 3rd year. You would have liked to have still thought that in year 3, you could have a little bit more of a base where getting 6 wins shouldn't have been a problem.
Well, they don't know what Willie B's like at night. That's an electric atmosphere, and their players have never seen anything like that. Apparently they have. Okay, so let's just lay that talking point to rest. Clemson obviously doesn't care one bit about playing us, if it's under the light, if it's in broad daylight, whatever.
I'm old enough to remember when Mark said Nick Harbor would be a huge weapon for Rattler. Seriously, though, it's inarguable that Rattler wasted his time on a program like South Carolina. Dude got the hell beat out of him all night.
On that Luke Doty play, was there a hold on that play? Of course there was. It was a clear hold, and what was interesting about the non-call to me, more than anything, I'm more just fascinated by it, was that it was right on the play. Like, it's right as Doty is running by. So if you're following the ball, you don't have to be watching just the offensive line. If you're just following the ball, you see the play occur. I mean, it was unbelievably evident. He's got DeMonte Capehart in a Draymond Green chokehold there.
And Mr. Bima, Mr. Crocodile Tears, I got so choked up during his post-game presser that I puked on my dog. This guy is phonier than Marv Albert's hairpiece. We fans, we deserve better than what Tanner and Beamer are force-feeding us. We're just so satisfied being losers that anyone who tells us he loves USC and it's his dream job to coach there gets a lifetime coach-like crap card, and I'm sick of it.
Until somebody ponies up the money and buys him out and gets him gone, it's going to be the same old crap. To me, it's either fish or cut bait, and you might as well go on ahead and cut bait now because it's not going to get you where you need to go. They kicked the can down the road with Will Muschamp for however many years, gave him a contract extension when he didn't deserve it, and then they're doing the same thing with Beamer. The same thing.
You know, watching the team get put out by an anaconda, just squeezed lifeless from the second play of the game on, just nothing there. So I think, you know, hey, Clayton White's got to go. And they've shown some signs, but, you know, it ain't there. And I don't think Dowell Loggins is going to be the guy.
Total, the Gamecocks had 169 yards.
Mm-hmm.
Total.
Right.
However, 92 of those yards were in the first quarter. So after the first quarter, they had 77 yards. That... it's impossible to win a football game with those type of statistics. There's just no way that it can happen. 77 yards in 3 quarters of football is abysmal. I mean, there's no other way to stack it. And so this performance was absolutely unacceptable. 77 yards in 3 quarters of offense.
Didn't think the Gamecocks could do much with the Clemson defense, and that proved to be the case. I did not think they would get that dominated. I did not think that Rattler would never. I don't think he had one clean pocket to throw from the whole game.
And if you don't change, you ain't worth a darn. And that's kind of where, that's why I stopped bragging about our offense, because it wasn't worth a darn no more. We were worse than, I didn't have any hope that we were going to win that ball game.
The story of this game is essentially like the offensive letdown of South Carolina. They were 2 of 13 on third down. Mike, I wanted to point that out.
Did you hear that, guys? 2 of 13, Joe.
Third down. I wanted to point that out because, you know, I think obviously the big story being the offensive letdown.
2 of 13.
To convert like that. You need to in a rivalry game like that.
I mean, you hear a stat like that, Mike. Trying to find something from a rhythm standpoint, 2 of 13. What does that do to an offense? I mean, I think it's easy. I think the answer is easy. We freaking saw it tonight.
Saw it tonight, yeah.
You know, I think there's some optimism to look forward to in the future. I think the defense looked really pretty good tonight when you consider it. Obviously, we had a great quarterback. But I really think if we bring Lou Holtz back for some of those really good speeches, and maybe even bring Brad Scott back, I think we got us a winner. should go Tigers.
How do you temper expectations as a Gamecocks fan? You look at history. You realize that this program has never done much of anything. You realize that last year, a season in which you won 8 games, that was the 15th time that it happened in school history. You realize that more than 8 wins, 9 or more, has only happened 7 times in school history. You just realize who you are. You realize what Gamecocks football has always been and maybe what it always will be.
For Clemson, they won 7 years in a row. Of course, from 1934 to 40. Of course, they won 3 or 4 years in a row prior to that several times in the series. Then they won 1976 to 78, they won 3 years in a row. From 1980 to 83, they won 4 years in a row. From 1988 to 91, Clemson won 4 years in a row. From 1997 to 2000, Clemson won 4 years in a row. From 2002 to 2005, Clemson won 4 years in a row. And then 2014 to 2022, they won 7 times in a row. Clemson has done it multiple times over South Carolina. They've owned this series.
South Carolina can't beat a team with the flu, as we now know they were getting IVs after pregame warm-up. The most humiliating thing for a Gamecock fan in that game is that you know that Clemson beat you, not really taking the vehicle over 30 miles an hour the entire game. You know, they're just kind of sputtering along, and they're beating you without any trouble. You know, they don't have to throw the ball. They don't have to do anything dangerous. They don't have to try trick plays. You know, they're beating you going in slow motion.
I'm not gonna fucking argue about it. Not gonna fucking argue about it. Their fucking lines of scrimmage have been fucking shit for years. That's what the fucking problem has been down here. All these fucking pussies are fucking horrendous. Fuck you. You don't know what the fuck you're talking about. They've got a bunch of fucking soft ass shitheads up front. You're fucking starting a guy from fucking Yale at center. Fucking ridiculous. Just shut the fuck up.
Well, I mean, I think it has to start with the offensive line. You know, it's been a mess the majority of the season, and it just makes things almost impossible for Dow Loggins as the play caller. You can call all the great plays you want to, but if your line just can't block in run game or protecting the passer, it doesn't matter what you call it in most cases.
To be honest with you, after watching South Carolina this past year and how bad their lines of scrimmage are, South Carolina's no better than Wake Forest or Syracuse or Georgia Tech. So that just flies out the window. Look, to be honest with you, home field advantage is big there because they're 58-66 overall. So, yeah, home field is a good home field advantage
compared to their away record.
You think about South Carolina going on the road in SEC play and getting their doors blown off, looking unprepared, uninspired, not ready to compete at the highest level. I mean, it goes at every single coach on this staff. Special teams took a step back. Pete Limbo's group. Defensively, again, I've already mentioned, guys, Clayton White. I mean, we're talking about his job status right now, so you know it wasn't a good year. Offensively with Dowell Loggins, personnel, you look at some of the play calling down the stretch and just some of the questionable play calls, the questionable personnel usage. I think the jury's still out on Dowell Loggins. And then Shane Beamer. Being the leader of this football team, being the leader of this football program, Shane Beamer hurt his brand as a head football coach this year. There is no question in my mind. Because when people think about from outside of South Carolina, from the SEC-wide perspective, the national perspective, when they think about Shane Beamer in 2023 and Gamecocks football, you know what people's only takeaway is? God, that dude said some crazy stuff. Remember when he broke his foot? That's all they're going to think about.
And I just have to be truthful here. The offense let the moment get to them early. Spencer Rattler completed pass to Xavier Leggett for a first down on the very first play of the game for South Carolina's offense. And then I believe the very next play, Rattler would also throw the ball once again to Xavier Leggett, this time on a swing pass. But in my opinion, it was a backward lateral. Xavier Leggett did not catch the pass. And neither he nor Marion Brown jumped on the football. At least they didn't seem to go after the football immediately once it hit the ground. And Clemson freshman safety Khalil Barnes picks it up and just jogs basically his way back to the end zone for a touchdown. And just like that, 35 seconds into the football game, Clemson is up 7-0, and their offense hasn't even touched the football yet.
We saw the product of what our offense has been the last, really last few weeks or so, honestly. The play calling has not been good with Dowell, and we saw it come alive last night. And unfortunately, that stupid score, there's no excuse for that. It's just ridiculous. Like, why are we trying to that same crap? Didn't work before. Why are we going back to it? You know, it's just, it's aggravating, man.
That was a fucking false start. You let that damn Clemson, so you let him fucking draw you off. What the fuck? Guys, goddamn. I mean, this is game 12. We're still fucking jumping off sides at home. What the fuck is wrong with y'all, man? What the fuck is wrong with this coaching staff? Why can't you fucking get it together? 3rd and 13. I'm starting to f***ing get mad now. Now it looks like they f***ing just gave it back to us. Nick Gargiulo, the Yale transfer, is all up in the damn referee's face showing it to him. Okay, well, that's great, dude. I mean, great, wonderful. Thanks. Thanks for letting us all know that they f***ing jumped off sides. Oh, no, it's another false start on South Carolina. Let's just continue f***ing shooting ourselves in the foot. Now you're starting to f***ing piss me off, you stupid bald-headed old son of a bitch. What the f*** is this? This is bullshit. 3rd and 18. I'm so f***ing tired of this. God! What are you doing? It's f***ing 3rd and 18. You don't know the goddamn blitz is coming. F***ing. Hey, y'all are f***ing sorry as f***. Y'all are so f***ing shit.
At least Dabo didn't Mac Brown him. He didn't walk up and choke the man on national television so that he could get a point across.
Boy, that would have been a tough way for Coach Beamer to end the season, getting choked out in game one and then in the final game. Just bookend the season perfectly
getting
for him.
Choked out by ACC coaches? That's not how this is supposed to go.
He certainly couldn't block ACC teams this year, so...
Do you remember that? We thought North Carolina was the 85 Bears coming out of that game, that Gene Chizik figured it out.
Yeah. I just never felt South Carolina had any chance to win. The Gamecocks had one drive in the game. One drive. And then it seemed like they couldn't get past midfield. They don't give you points for getting to midfield. You actually have to cross the goal line. You know, no points awarded for getting past midfield. So... You know, if this sounds harsh to some of you Gamecock fans who listen to the show, it's because some of your brethren decided I authored a homer pick in giving the Gamecocks 13 points. No, actually, turns out I gave you too much credit. You couldn't get to 13. 7. You know, that's the most you could get. 7. Playing at home.
Accept responsibility for the shortcomings that led to this 5-7 season, because it wasn't bad luck, it wasn't outside circumstances. This season truly was a reflection of the failures by South Carolina's coaching staff in the transfer portal and assembling the roster. That is why this season failed. Bottom line, point blank, they're Shane Beamer's broken foot, they're the chain gang eating hot dogs, their miserable existence comments, and their Beamer crying in the postgame. That's what I'll never forget from the 2023 season. Shane Beamer has got to find a way to steady his emotions and be the leader and the CEO that this football program needs. If the only requirement to be the head coach at South Carolina is to be a super fan, well, you can find some Joe Blow in Sumter or Aiken or Augusta or Greenville that'll do it for a lot cheaper than he will. Do you think Shane Beamer did good for his image as a head coach this year?
Not at all.
This season was a colossal failure.
These jokers came out wearing biker shorts with no knee pads, and I saw it too. I believe wide receivers get injured from getting hit on the knee. What in the hell is Shane Beamer doing, and how does he allow this to happen? Xavier Leggett looked like an idiot out there with his half shirt and biker shorts out, and then they go out and they crap the bed and lose the game. Mark, Beamer's got to go.
To be honest with you, I'm an eternal optimist,
But I think they can sign Patrick Mahomes, and it won't make a difference. I think the big question for South Carolina is, who do you want to be your next head coach? I don't see them winning but four games next year. You know, Shane Beamer has not got the job done. You know, he's got a couple five stars coming in, but it's only good enough for ninth in the SEC in recruiting class ranking. So it's not that it's outstanding. The Board of Trustees needs to take a hard look at Ray Tanner, right, and what he's done. The football hires of Muschamp and Shane Beamer, I mean, come on, it's just not very good.
Quite simply, it came down to the two running backs from Clemson. They had a net rushing yards of 219. So that's going to get the job done. And obviously, Klubnik is also a threat with his legs.
He's right behind us right now as a bunch of the Clemson players come out here to celebrate. But just want to continue. That's what you're seeing behind us right now.
Yeah, absolutely. And I mean, give credit where credit's due. Shipley and Maffa are really, really, really talented players. And they, you know, ripped up the South Carolina defense. I tweeted it in the middle of the game. It was kind of a death by a thousand paper cuts, really. By the way, the Tigers were running the ball. What that offense was able to do is essentially throw the car in neutral and just kind of stall out the game.
I'm going to flip this around because it's not going to make Gamecock fans happy here, but this is what you're having right now. You know, you have Clemson players literally dancing on your grave right now. You have Klubnik and you have some of the Clemson guys going in the cockpit taking photos. And again, I mean, this is the images that we're going to see all offseason. That's what's going on. Don't really know what else to say.
I'm officially off of the Shane train, this crap. I'm done with it, man. I'm done with it. I told you once before, I'll be a Gamecock a lot longer than he is, right? I ain't going nowhere. His time in Columbia is limited. It's just up to them to figure out when they're going to cut strings, because this guy's not a football coach. It's not good. You had a play last night where Amirian Brown was clearly out of bounds when he caught a ball that Spencer Rattler threw. Yeah, it was a gutty play by Rattler. It was a gutty play by Amirian Brown to catch it. But unfortunately, it was not a catch. Anybody could see it. You have a video board that's like 30 feet tall and 100 feet wide, that anybody could see it. But you're sitting here over here arguing with the official after this is over with. And then I guess when the call didn't go your way, you're placing your hands on your hips. You're all the way away from, detached from your team, detached from your players, the ones that you love, with this look on your face that's half Ted Bundy, half Bozo the Clown, staring off into space. You don't know what you're doing.
Maffa runs for 89. Shipley runs for 80 on Saturday night. Both of those guys, 169 yards. They match South Carolina.
Ooh, okay, yeah, that's not great.
South Carolina didn't even move the ball to even get Clemson pinned down deep in their own territory to give themselves a chance.
Yeah, I'm looking at these numbers. I'm not sure it could have been worse. I'm looking at 112 for Spencer, 13 to 35 for Mario.
I would just keep my mouth shut, and I'd just go to work every day and say, this is going to be a blue-collar kind of team now. We're going to work really hard, and we're not going to do all this flash and stuff. Substance is going to be the pivot.
Absolutely.
I don't know that they're capable of doing that, and I don't know that even works. I'm just telling you, the message is not going to resonate with that fan base.
He's got to change the messaging publicly.
And the tone of the message.
Yes, absolutely.
Absolutely.
No one wants to hear you up there whining and crying at the end of a game like that.
We go and we get this guy, and we just love him. The more crap he shovels, we just love it, because we're so butthurt after Spurrier leaves, after he gave us that taste, guys. He gave us that small appetizer of national relevance. Now we're willing to marry the girl who hit every branch on the ugly tree just so we won't be left at the altar again. What a pathetic fan base we are. I, for one, am sick and tired of being Ray Tanner's helpless cellmate, and I am through spending my hard-earned money watching a million-dollar coach who can't develop talent, doesn't game plan, and doesn't win more than five games in a season. Guys, I've got nothing else to say. I'm spent this season. I'll just talk to you guys after signing day.
If we'd had leadership on that team tonight, we'd been out there and the offense would, Rattler and Beamer would have been out there yelling at the offensive lineman, you get out there and you block this person. We just don't have that. I just don't see any kind of leadership under this team. It's like he wants to be everybody's friend. He doesn't want to go out there and actually be a leader and get on to people and hold people accountable. And that's the problem I have with Beamer. That's what I see. And I just don't think we'll ever do anything under Beamer. The more years we wait around, not going a different route, we're just delaying the inevitable. So that's where I stand on that. I know we're not going to fire him, but could we at least maybe fire Ray Tanner and then maybe have a new AD that holds him to a different accountability? Is that something we could do at least? I mean, I'm just searching for something because I just think we're going to get the same old next year. That's just the way I see it.
Texter here says, our end goal should be long sustained success between 8 and 10 win range year after year with possible 12 team college football playoff berth in the next 5 years. Texter, come on, man. Let's be realistic. Like, you gotta have realistic expectations.
The end game for South Carolina should not be championships.
That was pretty, it was a pretty bad game. Offense is trash. Dowell Loggins' play calling, pretty terrible. Pretty
the tone was set early in that game on the scoring drive, believe it or not. The tone was set on that fourth and goal from the end line. When you have to run a trick play, fourth and goal from the end line, in hopes of scoring a touchdown, right there in that moment, you are telling your team, you are telling Clemson, you are telling everyone watching that game, we're not physical enough to compete up front. We don't have the physicality to win this football game. If we win this football game, we are going to have to win this game through smoke and mirrors. The tone was set at that point. And South Carolina played that way the rest of the night. Soft. Played soft. They were soft up front. Just disgusting. I mean, it was a disgusting performance offensively. And again, I thought the tone was set on that. I mean, when you're having to call some fluky trick play on the inch line, that tells me everything I need to know. Dowell Loggins was in over his head from that moment. You just knew at that moment, it's going to be a long night.
So, I don't know. You just got me over. I'm so aggravated talking about Shane Beamer crying. Well, I'm 90 years old. When you lose something dear to your heart, you're supposed to cry.
Mm-hmm.
And that's what the difference in your dancing coach, Dabo. But Dabo, I don't know. I got to live and take it for a year. From all you Tiger fans, man, and three hosts on the radio show. I got to listen to them for a year. Boy, I tell you what.
I'm just trying to say that if the environment is as great as it says it is, or I heard that it is, then how can he be 19-24 against Power 5 at home the last 10 years?
Mickey, they had to play Alabama at home.
But I'm not talking about that. I'm talking about Citadel beat them. I'm talking about
App State. Don't forget App State.
App State. A bad Florida team this year. That's a bad football team.
It's ironic that their head coach talked about how loud the environment was the week prior, and then also in the same sentence went to complain about how everybody left early.
What would be wrong with trying a jet sweep with Nicholas Harbor? The reason I keep talking about that, I mean, Clemson did a jet sweep two times in the 2014 game against South Carolina. Artavis Scott scored touchdowns on two jet sweeps. If you can't win with Rattler, you damn sure ain't winning with Urkel. Okay, well, we'll see about that. F***ing Urkel. I was waiting for that damn shit to come from somebody. I knew that was f***ing coming.
From a standpoint of
you know, South Carolina and their chances to win. They had no chance to win. None. Zero. Not an empty set. None. They had 169 yards. You have no chance to win. When you're putting together 169 yards of offense, I mean, Clemson's offense wasn't good, but it was double that. When the most you can muster is 169 yards of offense, you're not winning. That's the end of the story. And it was clear going in, South Carolina wasn't good enough to win this game. It was clear. That's how it played out. Clemson better than South Carolina, period. Here, there, anywhere you want to play it, Clemson better than South Carolina. Better than this version of South Carolina. What you nimrods who thought that it was like homerism didn't get is that Clemson's defensive secondary light years better than the one Rattler threw for 500 yards on. Light years better. Clemson's whole defense light years better. That Clemson defense last year wasn't good. That was the outlier Clemson defense. That wasn't good. Clemson was back this year to be in the regular Clemson defense, and it's been really good all year.
If Plan A works at South Carolina, you've got Dekarion Joyner in the backfield. Shane Beamer's Plan A has to work better than it worked this year. Across the board, with everybody. You got to have better Plan A's.
With your gravelly voice, could I just get one touchdown, Carolina?
Touchdown, Carolina! You know, dang it, man. I was thinking to myself, this is what Todd Ellis feels like every day. Touchdown, Carolina! Touchdown, Khalil Barnes.
South Carolina in the last 10 years has a losing record against Power 5 competition at Williams-Brice.
Wow.
So it's just not Clemson they're losing to. They're losing to everybody else, too. Yeah, that's not very intimidating.
Wes Goodwin versus Dow Loggins. Listen, dude, I mean, was it just a matter of depth and talent, or did Wes Goodwin actually put it up on D-Log?
I mean, that performance tonight was inexcusable. I mean, I give Clemson a lot of credit. Their defense is for real. Everything Clemson was not this year, that defense is still the Clemson defenses we're used to seeing in the 2010s, if you will, when they were in the national titles. But, I mean, just like the other losses, really questionable play calling at times, really questionable personnel usage at times. And Dabble Loggins has a lot to prove. He's still got a lot to prove moving forward.
It's embarrassing that we couldn't help him more. I mean, to start the season with 9 sacks by North Carolina and to finish the season the way we did, I couldn't believe he only got sacked twice. I mean, it looked like he was getting nailed every play. It's a credit to him that he didn't take 10 sacks in that game. And I mean, took hard hits. I mean, there were times where I was worried he wasn't going to get back up. So, I mean, whatever it takes, portal, recruiting, new coach, we got to do better on the line of scrimmage. We know that. That's been running to the ground. But, I mean, Spencer just took, I mean, he got the hell beat out of him Saturday night.
Once it was obvious that all the applause and cock-a-doodle-doos and noise weren't doing anything and weren't going to change a damn thing about that game, can you blame the fans for being demoralized at that point? I can't. All the cock-a-doodle-doos in the world weren't going to change the fact that Clemson was beating you, driving the vehicle 30 miles an hour.
You have to be tough to be a Gamecock fan. You got to have thick skin. And I'm not seeing it. The thing is if they do fire Beamer, at some point Ray Tanner has to really open the checkbook and get a really good coach in up there. Stop hiring Muschamps, and as much as I like the guy, stop hiring a Beamer. Go get a good coach.
South Carolina was sold a bag of goods when Shane Beamer was hired, that Carolina was going to, he was going to build an elite coaching staff and have elite coordinators and elite assistant. Let's say you bring Clayton White back, right, the defensive coordinator. And it's going to be a prove-it year for Clayton White, no question. But, I mean, it's just as much a prove-it year for Dabble Loggins, guys. The offense statistically was worse. Worse. And then you close out the season like this.
Beamer was saying that the program is the strongest it's ever been. My thing is, man, like this. With that kind of thinking, man, it won't be too much longer, man, where he probably won't even have a job. I mean, Mississippi State has the same record that we have at this point, and you see they wasted enough time doing what they needed to do with Arnett.
Yes, the one touchdown that the Gamecocks had was a horrible, horrible play call.
Yes.
And for our listeners, anyone that did not miss that, this was essentially, and I'll put this in the most simplified terms as possible, this was a double reverse that ended up going to Luke Doty, former quarterback, wide receiver. And I'm pretty sure that the first read on that was he was supposed to throw it to Spencer Rattler in the end zone, which, again, makes it an even stupider play call. The entire time, I don't care. Yeah, we scored. That's great. It's the only offensive points or the only points we had in the entire game. But the whole time we're running that play, I'm screaming, this is dumb, this is dumb, this is dumb.
I was like, that was the ugliest thing I've ever seen in my life. Like, it was great that we got a touchdown, but you're right. Just awful.
When they did that little reverse, I mean, Kate Park, my man, was getting hugged. I mean, the guy had his arms over his shoulder. And the back judge, I'm like, what are you looking at, guy? That's what you're supposed, that's your job, to look for a hold.
What was the plan? Is what I'm asking. Did you really think you were going to line up without gadgets and tricks? And I'm not talking about the Philly special from the one. That's been done for 15 years, guy. What did you think was going to get you the win? Did you try everything that you could to poke your chest out and say, last year wasn't a fluke, we're going to do it again? And even if we don't have a better team, because they didn't, and they should have known that, point blank, even if we don't have the better team, we're going to do some crazy stuff to make you think this might not go your way. Look at who scared you on the field. I wasn't even that scared of Leggett. I'll be like watching him out there against Clemson's defense. He didn't scare me. Wells was a concern last year. Leggett was not for me.
Yeah, I mean, I'm not worried about him when I know he's going up against another future NFL player.
Exactly.
Yeah. A lot of it's been complimentary of Loggins, what he's done this year. But I'm going to tell you this. Saturday night was a pathetic game plan. And you can send four people out all you want, but if you can't block, it doesn't matter. And I don't understand. I mean, Clemson is the best. Next to maybe, I would say they're as good a defense as we played all year. And our package didn't do anything to help us out. And without naming kids' names, 53-55, the offensive line coach, I don't know what he's doing. I mean, just fundamentally, it's pitiful. And they need to take a look at that in the offseason.
He wears his emotions on his sleeve. I don't think he would be Shane Beamer if he didn't. I mean, coaches handle things different ways. I don't think, certainly Muschamp, you'd never see him tear up. Spurrier never really had a situation where he had to tear up. Beamer is just, you can't say he's a young guy. I mean, he's 45 years old. You know, it's not like he's 32, 33, or in his 20s. He's 45 years old. This is his nature. And, you know, he was emotional about losing.
Kroger was really the guy that was the biggest disappointment and the guy that they expected to be a weapon to do the things you just mentioned and, you know, help them win the battle of field position and have teams start deep in their own territory quite a bit. And he just didn't get it done this year.
South Carolina, Shane Beamer's 8-1 at night. 8-1. At night, Las Vegas says, we don't care about night, day, noon, 3:30. We care who the better team is.
Year three, Shane Beamer, not only 5-7, but I guess the Kentucky win was the big win for you this year. I guess that's the case. Not one to not a season to write about. And now looking at next year, I told you before, we're Shane Beamer now looking at a rough year four, and who knows what the transfer portal could look like for him. But with high expectations, remember the preseason we talked about South Carolina and how they were really getting ahead of over their skis a little bit and how they were really promoting how this is going to be great. You open up by losing North Carolina. No shame in the Georgia loss. Weren't really in the Tennessee game. Florida beat you late. Missouri pounded you, didn't really have a chance at A&M, and you lose to Clemson, and your five wins were against Furman, a Mississippi State team that went 5-7, a Jacksonville State team that went, I was going to a bowl, it's a winning record there, Vanderbilt that went 2-10.
And then last night you start bawling at the end of the press conference. I don't know where your head's at. I don't think you may be fit up here, and that's okay, because there are a lot of us that need a little brain straightening out every now and again. But I don't think that you
are emotionally equipped to be a head football coach, at least not at this level. So I'm not going to sit here and say fire Clayton White, fire Dowell Loggins. Fire. No, if they don't have a leader that's worth a shit, they're not going to be worth a shit.
Man, that was one of the worst games I've seen in a while. I remember the 30-0 game a while back, and I don't even know, man. That's just, it sucks because our defense played our hearts out, and offense just couldn't do anything.
You know that game felt a lot like the 30-0 game, except Clemson offensively wasn't as good that night or tonight as they were. But two of that game had the 30-0 feel for sure, which is obviously wildly disappointing. It's hard to be optimistic about the state of Gamecocks football, where it's headed, where it's going, certainly where it's currently at.
I think there came a point where Clemson knew Carolina could not beat them in the trenches on the defensive side of the ball when South Carolina was on defense. They certainly couldn't snip Clemson when the Tigers were on defense.
I was a little surprised. I knew Clemson's defense was good, but I didn't know they were going to hold us like they did.
Yeah, it just felt like Clemson kind of kept them at arm's length, and that's just, to me, Williams-Brice had to be more of a difference maker, and I just felt like those two early turnovers never really allowed that to materialize.
After that touchdown, they had like 1 yard over the next like six drives, and it's like, they're literally doing nothing on offense.
It was punt, 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 and then and downs.
Yeah.
So I forgot how many straight punts it was, and then you get stopped on downs. South Carolina just couldn't do anything on offense. And again, this goes back to the fact that Clemson's really good on defense. They've got some dudes who are going to make some money in the NFL on that defensive side of the ball. They have them on all three levels.
When you're taking it on the chin, or when you have taken it on the chin, show a little pride still. It kind of goes to the point about South Carolina. You know, you're asking me about Shane Beamer, and I do want to ask, what was he thinking was going to win him the game? Did he think he was going to line up and protect? Did he think he was going to line up and throw it to Leggett every down or use his tight end? Like, did he think he's going to give it to a D2 transfer running back and score? Did he think his defense was going to score for him?
I don't know what his offensive game plan was, but it wasn't helped by the fact that Trey Knox was knocked out of the game. Mario Anderson thought he was Mario Kart. He didn't know his. I mean, he got hit where he didn't even know his name.
Did you see that when he popped up? How big his eyes were?
Oh yeah,
that was the first time where you're like, "Oh, buddy, yeah, you need to take a minute."
I'm fucking done with this shit, man. I don't know. This is not good. You don't want to fucking win. Just give them the damn fucking game. Just fucking give it to them. You fucking can't catch. You fucking give them a fucking touchdown. The only damn touchdown you fucking... This offense is fucking horrendous. Fucking horrendous. What the fuck is going on? I don't understand. Fucking horrendous. This is just poor coaching and not being fucking prepared. Now, these guys are just... This is just stupid.
They'll be better off just continuing to play this game in the upstate, because the last four games that have been played at Williams-Brice Stadium, this offense has combined for a total of 2 touchdowns in 16 quarters. That's the last four games.
Crazy.
Going back to 17, 19, 21, 23. Clemson has walked right in and walked right out with very little issue.
Exactly. Brad, I never predicted you would ever get 1,000 yards. I don't know where the hell you're getting that from. That's the dumb. I mean, I never said that. Never. Ever. Not once. And you can laugh all you want, Brian. You guys are part of the problem if you're going to sit here and throw crap like that in my face today. Don't do it. Don't do it. Don't come at me with lies or what you think is said. This Elijah Caldwell thing, same thing.
It was really embarrassing when this is not the worst loss to a Clemson team that South Carolina has faced, but it kind of seems like it because of that of that scoop and score. After that, I knew they lost the game.
There were a lot of moments early on that it didn't feel like South Carolina's night, for sure.
If they can't get this offensive line next year going forward, those road games are going to be brutal for this team. And would a weird scenario be like 3-9? Like, would that just be the absolute worst?
I think
because
Shane,
you're playing Alabama on the road, you're playing Clemson on the road. Am I thinking way too far ahead? Can you please calm me down?
Some of your antics during the game were just, I'll be honest, I'm a little shocked that he had something to say to Nate Wiggins.
Yeah,
coming on the field and talking. You don't talk to the team's players.
Don't ever talk to other players.
Xavier Leggett, instead of, I don't know, putting on the uniform correctly, as you're instructed and have been doing since Pee Wee football, why are you taking out all the pads in your football pants, cutting up the sides of them so you can hike them up to make sure you've got the shortest shorts on possible? That's just on you for trying to look cool, and then it came out to bite you. The equipment room has all the pads available for you. You should probably try to use them. And just, Coach Beamer, don't talk to another team's players. I don't care if that would have been Kentucky on the other side, Vanderbilt, Georgia, Clemson. It doesn't matter. You don't talk to another team's players, period, end of story.
Yeah,
Beamer, and come onto the field to do it.
Yeah, Beamer rushed out on the field not to go straight to Leggett. That's what needs to be acknowledged here about what occurred.
You cannot talk to another team's players, period, end of story.
There's just not a place for that in the game. Not. Just never going to condone that. Don't do it.
You made Clemson kick uncomfortable field goals, you kept them out of the end zone, and you still lost by 2 scores.
Yeah.
You have arguably the most talented quarterback you've ever had in this program. We can argue production, we can argue wins, we'll have that discussion, and you know, we will not come to the conclusion that he was the best, but he's the most talented. And to have him at home the last 2 games and score a combined 24 points with the season on the line is pretty disappointing.
Yeah,
I think it'd be fair to say that the way this season ended is incredibly disappointing.
I was just surprised at some of his decision making, especially not going for it on fourth down, you know, in the fourth quarter. You got to play to win. And it just felt like they were just trying to hang in there and stay close.
Gamecock, Larry, you keep telling Dabo to come on down, come on down. Well, the last 4 times he's come down there, y'all scored 2 touchdowns. 2 touchdowns and 4 trips.
Mm-hmm.
I know what he's going to say. 2024, 12-0, they'll beat the Eagles for the NFC, and then they'll go on to the Super Bowl.
I'm probably where a lot of people aren't, and I'm not one of those quick-fire guys, but I'm like, I'm done with the Shane Beamer area. This guy obviously cannot hire a good staff. I mean, literally, we are going into year 4. And these guys, man, look, as far as I'm concerned, you getting paid now, you employees. So that changes the whole game. So, you know, the expectations should be different, and it's not. And so I'm getting so tired of just watching. There's no way that you're going into year 4 and you can't even get a first down.
They haven't been able to stop the run. They haven't been able to run the football. They pretty much knew they weren't going to be able to run coming into this year. Then you start adding the offensive line issues with injuries. And, you know, even when it was fully healthy, it gave up 9 sacks to its quarterback. Clemson's defense is really, really good, and USC tried everything it could to get the offense moving. They tried different formations, tried to run screens, tried to chip, tried to block, tried to do everything. You can't run offense if you can't block. You just can't do it, and Clemson's line was just busting USC up front. So that's why they lost the way they did, and, you know, it's a bad end to a bad season.
We've won 5 times in 45 years. At Williams Brice against them. So, I mean, I think when the 2 years from now, when that rolls around, I don't think we need to bring that up as a talking point.
Spencer Rattler, who is 4th in the SEC, averaging 293 yards a game through the air and completing 70% of his passes, they held him to 16 of 32 for 112 yards, 1 interception, no touchdowns. He had the worst game. He had a quarterback rating of 79.8, the worst game of his career. Rattler probably spent at least a couple hours the next day in the massage room and all those fancy things they have in there, you know, to keep him feeling better because, man, he was lit up almost every time he dropped back to pass.
Yeah, I feel bad for that kid because they really took it to
the next 6 or 7 possessions, which yielded a total of single digit yards, or maybe it was 1 yard. I think it was 1 yard over the next either 6 or 7 possessions in total. It just mind boggling to me.
Besides Khalil Barnes, the real star of the game, Jonathan Weitz. White's 50-yarder, 49-yarder, 42-yarder, 3-for-3 on the field goals, 1-for-1 the extra points, and Clemson wins 16-7 down in Columbia to continue an unbelievable streak now. One in the last four trips to Columbia, Clemson's outscored the Gamecocks 118-20. I don't get that whole. I listened to South Carolina postgame show Saturday night, and there's a lot of pride in. Well, we didn't allow an offensive touchdown. Well, great, you lost the game. You also had 169 yards of offense. So that's just like reaching for all that.
Look, they lost, and that at the end of the day, that's the point of the conversation. They got beat.
A night that all Gamecock fans just want to get out of their memory bank, get out of their mind as soon as possible. It's really, really easy to sit on it, to stew on it. But my advice to you and my advice to myself is to not do that. It's never fun to lose to your rival. It's never fun to get shut out from a bowl game. It isn't great.
You know, I just kind of looked at it, and I mean, I'd say they got dominated. And sometimes that happens, and when you don't play your best, and nobody did. When the other team's playing, you know, pretty doggone good at a high level.
Spencer Rattler basically stared down Xavier Leggett and just threw the ball up to him. And look, it was just a horrible decision by Spencer Rattler to throw that football. One of the worst decisions that he had made all season, and unfortunately, it came at a really bad time at the start of this game.
South Carolina's beaten Clemson 5 times in 43 years at home. Is that right?
That is correct. Not in 43 tries, in
43 years.
I heard more about Clemson's record there leading into this game than I ever recall hearing before. I did not realize it was so lopsided there. I really didn't.
I knew the last three. I held on to that 102-13, which is now, 118-20 in the last four trips to Williams-Brice Stadium. Clemson's beaten South Carolina. That's an average margin of victory of 24.5 points.
I mean, how do you go to an SEC stadium and do that to an SEC? I don't know how that happens.
And God, it's worse in Columbia. Clemson owns they own that rivalry in Columbia for whatever reason it is. And so I think Gamecock fans, you'd be well served to really relish and celebrate those wins for Clemson when they come, because it doesn't feel like they come often. Just not as often as most folks would like. You can basically account on you're going to get 3 to 4 wins over Clemson every decade. And that's in a good decade. And it's unfortunate where it felt like this time last year, South Carolina was, you know, had at least made up ground on Clemson in the rivalry, right? And now a year later, fast forward to what just happened, you look at the two programs, even in a down season, Dabo's worst team in over a decade, that's the result.
When I sort of may have tapped out on Beamer for South Carolina's coach was after the Missouri game. Because after the Missouri game, Missouri whooped them up and down the field, slaughtered them. And after the Missouri game, he goes into the press conference, and you know what his statement is? His statement is, you know, with all the building that they're doing here and all the improvements, you would think we would have a better room to have our press conference in. That was his complaint. He was complaining in a sort of an immature way, sort of a whiny way about the press room after losing by, you know, 30 to Missouri. That's not what your focus should have been. And it sort of turned me off on him. It's like, that's just an excuse. And it's just a whiny baby excuse when your team just got your head handed to you on a platter. You ought to be talking about that, not the state of the Missouri press room.
We were not better in almost any category from the coach we fired. That's how bad we coached on offense this year. We had Spencer freaking Rattler, and we couldn't even figure out how to make him successful. And if you look at all these players we have, and if you look at the quarterbacks and the guys on offense, and like, hell, if we can't win with Spencer Rattler, we can't win with nobody. We just wasted that kid year. We just got to coach a whole lot better on offense than even have. If we do the same thing we did this year, it'll be a worse. We had Spencer Rattler and did nothing with him. I don't care who you put at quarterback. You ain't gonna do nothing with this offense. It's tough.
I think a lot of these people were not making really good points. I think that they were just really embarrassed that they got beat down and at their home field. and that more importantly, they won't be going to a bowl.
It's always nice when South Carolina's home for Christmas, right? I mean, let's just call it like it is.
Right.
It's just the world is right when Clemson beats South Carolina and South Carolina's home for Christmas.
It feels so good knowing that for 364 days, whatever the math is, I ain't got to listen to them anymore. And I don't care how ugly it was or how conservative the offense was. Clemson won. To be honest, you know, not to go back, but if you're conservative last year, I wouldn't have to put up with this for the previous 360-some-odd days. And so, and again, I keep hearing how tough of a place that is to play down there. When's the last time Clemson lost down there, y'all?
Yeah, it's been a while.
Their fans are good. I mean, again, they do get behind their team for the first half, and then the doors get shut. I mean, Clemson got – I mean, they got called for a penalty for excessive noise back at St. Danny Ford's last game whenever they were shutting the doors going to their cars at the end of the game, and so they got a penalty for that for excessive noise.
No creativity whatsoever. I don't know what I don't know what we're paying Dowell Loggins for. Just sit on his ass up there in that f***ing box and look stupid. Look like Spence from the King of Queens. Look like Spence from the King of Queens, perhaps, or Spence Gibbs from the Uncle Lou comment section. Maybe we should see if those two can put their head together. They'd probably be better off.
We need to get rid of the offensive line coach guy, pack it back. I don't get a bowl game. He doesn't get another year next year. And our O-line is soft as tissue paper. My God.
I'm not sure that this is working. I'm just not, from a South Carolina standpoint. We shall see. You know, obviously they're going to have to win more games next year. They're going to have to look better. You're not going to be able, if you're Shane Beamer, you're not going to be able to keep resorting back to, we beat Clemson and Tennessee 2 years ago. You know, that worked in the short term, but now we've moved past that.
If next year's like this, next year, Beamer will be on the hot seat. I don't care about the injury excuse. That needs to stop. Injury excuse. Injuries happen. It's called next man up.
I mean, you got to look at guys like Justin Steele. So the receiving game was not very good this year. He hasn't recruited any big receivers. Running backs have been terrible. You got to look at Montario Hardesty.
You got to a point in the game where you knew Spencer Rattler was just not going to have time to take a downfield shot.
That's right. And I honestly, I'm shocked after watching the way the offensive line folded. I'm shocked Clemson only sacked him twice. Now, there were 8 quarterback pressures in the game, and he got hit a million times.
This is the biggest compliment I could pay to the Clemson defense. I truly was on the borderline, felt sorry for Rattler.
Yeah, I really did.
Rattler was consistently under duress pretty much the entire game.
Spencer Rattler was like statistically under duress 56% of Carolina's snaps. It's just a recipe for disaster.
Frankly, I'm surprised the guy didn't get killed last night or get seriously injured.
All this emotional BS from Beamer isn't a good leadership strategy. Temper tantrums, whining and crying, and has to rub off on the team in a negative way. Comes off as weak. I think it would benefit Beamer to tone it down a little bit. But, you know, he's going to do what he wants, and it is what it is, and whatever.
We all know that football, the game is won in the trenches. Why does that not ever seem to be a focal point of South Carolina for the last 3 to 5 years? All we've ever heard is that we need to get offensive line fixed. We need to get offensive line fixed. Why hadn't they got it fixed yet?
Clemson not only won, but won comfortably. In a way in which no one ever felt like they were threatened. 169 yards for South Carolina is a pathetic effort. You know, the one thing South Carolina could do was move the football, except when you go against Clemson. And you can't run the football. You have no time to throw the football. You have no time to allow routes to develop down the field, right? And you got you got Spencer Rattler running for his life.
It's got to be concerning if you are a fan of the Gamecocks that the offense statistically was better last year. The record was better. Everything was better about the offense. Xavier Leggett, guys, moving to him. I thought thought for the most part he got shut down. You know, we talked about that matchup all week long. Nate Wiggins against Xavier Leggett. Give Wiggins credit. I thought he won the battle.
Hey, fellas, all I got to say is 73-43-4.
There was just no way they were going to move the ball with regularity or score on Clemson. And again, 169 yards of offense blows out. That sucks. It's terrible. And Clemson's defense is largely responsible for that. So that's the reality of the game going in. And it wasn't a homer pick. It was actually a smart pick. Now, you people who wrote me and said it was a homer pick, you people were homers. So you get mirrors and you check yourself next time, because you'll know who the real homer is. It's you. Because there was just no way you were winning this game. No way. I mean, you had no chance. I mean, Clemson smothered you to a degree that, you know, I'd have to think whether Clemson smothered anybody else to that degree all year. South Carolina's offense largely didn't function all season.
It sucks to have the goal of just getting back to a bowl game. And I mean, at least that's what we were doing. I mean, even, you know, went to a few under Muschamp. But whenever it comes to the point where that's like the only goal set instead of like, you know, a conference championship, a division championship, maybe. I mean, but that's, you're right. It's kind of like where it's at right now.
We didn't try one field goal. I mean, that's pretty bad. You can't even get close enough to attempt a field goal. It's pretty bad for an offense.
Just watching that game, and you're watching Clemson's defense just win play after play after play.
I think there's probably a lot of Gamecock fans not happy with Beamer right now. But I just did not like the postgame. Just really didn't like that. I thought that was maybe the wrong moment to be in that sort of state, that emotional state. I think the emotion people wanted to see was anger. I think Gamecock fans wanted to see the Shane Beamer that kicked the Gatorade bucket that broke his foot. You know, like, mad that you lost, not crying about the effort of your players.
Man, read the room a little bit. This is not what people want to hear right now.
Maybe this will be a lesson to those in-state offensive linemen. You can either come practice with the best defensive linemen, or you can play at game day and let everybody around the whole world see you get abused by our defensive linemen.
The tone, as I said after the game, guys, I thought was set when you ran a trick play down in the goal line on 4th and inches. When you knew beyond a shadow of a doubt, we are not physical enough. We are not man enough to gain a yard. We're not man enough to gain an inch unless we run some smoke and mirrors trickery.
Capehart, that's who I was saying. Capehart got put in handcuffs in the backfield.
Oh, yeah. That's what you're talking about, the holding there. Yeah, oh, yeah. Bad misholding on that play for sure. It was so hard for them to score. And even on that 4th down play, it was so hard for them to score because Clemson knew what was coming. It was so difficult for them to find the end zone. I kind of thought to myself, they might not score another touchdown.
Tommy Suggs and I talked a little bit in postgame about, you know, just some things kind of after the whistle and how the game is officiated differently, conference to conference. And I just look back at the hit that Spencer took. He got rid of the ball, delivered. The hit was on time, but the defender kind of picked him up and took his weight and Spencer's weight onto the ground back inside the 5-yard line there. I think that was 4th quarter, maybe right towards the beginning of the 4th quarter. And you're just like, wow, you know, you just can't take many hits like that. And, you know, I think certainly some Carolina fans, probably even coaches and guys up here in the booth with us felt like South Carolina was hard done by some of the calls tonight. But unfortunately, you got to make your own plays. You got to go out there and take the game into your hands and not count on the officials to do it for you.
I think Shane Beamer's on the hot seat. I think Shane Beamer should be on the hot seat. Shane Beamer's trying to win in the SEC with a group of five or an FCS offensive and defensive line. You're seeing how that goes.
What was up with Dallas play calling this weekend? Because they maybe had just not seen it look as disjointed. I think a lot of that had to do with what Clemson was doing to you. Clemson seemed prepared for everything you were attempting, no pun intended, to throw at them. Because they were.
You have to move on from this, and it's going to sting for a long time. This is a really tough way to end the season, and going into an offseason without postseason play just really, really stinks and leaves a terrible
taste in your mouth.
Pass incomplete. They just can't get a damn thing going. I mean, it's just the same old f***ing shit. I mean, same f***ing shit. No creativity whatsoever out here. I mean, you're not playing Vanderbilt, guys. I mean, you're playing a top 10 defense. I mean, you're going to have to do something different to try to mix some shit up to get the ball going. God damn it, what the fuck was that? This is atrocious. This is fucking atrocious. You're not even going to fucking do it. Jesus, man. Are you even trying to fucking win the game, you son of a bitch? This is fucking stupid.
What does Clemson do a really good job of? Preventing explosive plays. South Carolina did not get any of them on Saturday night, and the results kind of speak for themselves.
Gamecocks fall 16-7. 5-7 is the final record. 3-5 in conference play.
So we have two programs seemingly going in different directions. And this is by far Beamer's worst season. 5 wins.
The things that I'll remember the most from the 2023 season? Dekarion Joyner telling me to shut the F up. Shane Beamer breaking his foot in frustration after the Florida game. Mentioning the chain gang eating hot dogs as that was the biggest problem of tonight. That was the most disappointing thing. Telling folks to find some joy after the after the Jacksonville State game and mentioning folks have a miserable existence and attacking those in the fan base because people may not be all that thrilled with how the JSU game went. The bottom line is this. You failed. You failed in 2023. You failed in year 3 of Shane Beamer. That's it. South Carolina may not have very high expectations and high standards, but guys, you miss a bowl game with Spencer Rattler at quarterback? You failed. You failed. So, my overall grade, guys, for South Carolina football in 2023 is an F. Maybe that F stands for find some joy. But either way, it is an F.
Find some joy.
Fun!
Surprise!
You didn't think I could do it again, did you?
The joke's on you, Jack! Yeah! We did it again! We did it again!
Legendary. That's going to be great.